Hey, this is Mike Herrera. You're listening to Magnified Pod.
This is a yelling podcast. From Pokinatcha to plans and everything in between, this is Magnified Pod, the only podcast that discusses culture, religion, politics, and the entire discography of everyone's favorite Left Coast punks, MXPX.
Woo.
And we're back.
Mm-hmm.
I am Andrew.
I'm Derry Merbles, a.k.a. John.
And this is our podcast. Mm-hmm. We are doing it again.
Yep. Sometimes you have to.
Pokinatcha revisited. You know, we excogitated.
We did.
Over this. And we decided it was about time to do this podcast at our house again.
It was going to cause ignominy not to not to revisit it.
Exactly. So we are doing this podcast, the Pokinatcha album, again. And some people might be thinking, you guys, you already did this. Why would you possibly need to do this again?
Well, get off our ass.
Yeah, exactly. First thing, why do you got to be such a dick?
Yeah.
We're doing this for you, okay?
Yeah. Calm down.
We have gotten no complaints about us doing this.
Yeah.
Anyway, so we're doing this again because I went back and I listened to our first episode,
mm-hmm.
and we technically only covered 9 of 21 songs on the album.
Right.
And then we highlighted 2 others for Mike's Vocab Corner.
Indeed.
Where we brought up the words excogitate and ignominy. So we didn't even technically discuss half the album.
Yeah.
And we have been wanting, if we're going to do this in earnest, to discuss every single album.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny, and I pulled this quote from that first episode right before we got into discussing the album, and I texted this to you because I thought it was so funny of things to come. And I quote, this is me speaking. I said, also, recognizing that we just can't, for the sake of your time and our time, listen to and dissect every single Pokinatcha song.
How naive we were. Such sweet summer children.
To think that we were had any concern that there was a time when we were concerned about how long the podcast was going.
Yeah.
We're like, oh man, we went for an hour and a half. Is that too long?
I got to say, listening back to the first ep, which I did too, I was like, you know, this isn't as bad as I feared it would be.
No.
I feel like we've had several comments that were like, took you guys a while to find your sea legs, so I was kind of nervous for what it would entail, but I was like, you know, I pretty much stand by most of this.
I feel like it's fair. It did take us a little bit of time to get into a rhythm.
Yeah.
Because it was new. And this is episode 33.
Woo.
And I feel like I'm still figuring things out.
Yeah.
Because literally just today I was like, why don't I see what I can do about making the vocal quality sound a little bit better.
Yeah.
And so I went online. It literally took me just 3 minutes of Googling to try and find and tweak some of the audio. And I feel like it sounds better.
Yeah. So Derry Merbles levels.
Yes.
Of goodness now. I will say that's one thing that listening back to the first episode, I'm like, ooh, that definitely improved.
Well, here's the other issue was that first episode we were recording in my dining room,
mm-hmm.
That a little bit more echoey.
Yep.
We're in your basement now in a smaller room. It has carpeting, so
tricked out. It's studio.
It's tricked out studio. We have been using all of our Patreon money. we are bringing in the highest quality
That's right.
equipment. decorating it with the best in class of MXPX postcards.
Mm-hmm.
Where did that
the sticker?
The sticker did.
I gave up. It's upstairs now.
Okay,
we gotta find a better use for it here somewhere.
I guess so. I mean, we could. I don't know. We could put it on. I thought about like putting it on my laptop, putting it over my
that'd be pretty cool.
My Apple icon or something like that. But that's something else that is a little bit of an update. We are getting closer to launching the merch store.
Woo.
Basically, what I'm waiting on before launching is I have ordered a couple sample things because I want to make sure that the shirts and other things that people could potentially buy mm-hmm. are actually of good quality.
Yeah.
I don't want people to shell out money for a shirt and then have it suck.
Right.
So I'm waiting to get some of those things in the mail.
Yeah.
See if they're any good.
Yeah.
And then I'll launch it. And
excited to see it.
Yeah, I'm curious to see what the quality of one of the hoodies is. I think it's an American Apparel hoodie.
Fancy.
So
what about the bathrobes? How those turn out?
They have a space that is like just wide open for your junk to be
cool,
on display.
Cool. Yeah,
it's that you can tie it, but there's always going to be a hole for your junk to hang out on.
Yeah, that's just what our listeners prefer.
You know, you gotta keep it aired out.
That's right.
That's what I'm always saying.
You are.
So we will keep you posted on mm-hmm. that merch. Hey, John, why don't we toast? You've got the last of your Trader Joe's bourbon.
Because their sponsorship is ending this week. So.
This is our last week of Trader Joe's. Trader Joe's bourbon. It gets you fucked.
Eggs, yeah.
the tagline. Yep, that's. You know, whenever I go into Trader Joe's, I see their they have a display with our faces on it, of you and me, cardboard cutouts of us holding bottles,
mm-hmm.
and a little air bubble above my head that says, "It gets you fucked."
Someday. That dream will be realized. Maybe we'll have an actual ad copy to read at some point in our lives.
I would love that. Do you know how happy that would make me to read some banal copy from some... It's like, do you like mattresses? You spend X amount of your life lying on a mattress.
Yeah.
Now, why would you spend one on a low-quality mattress?
Just type in Mattressfied Pod. I don't know. I could do better than that, but
no,
it was
Mattressfied,
the dome.
Mattressfied Pod is actually pretty good.
If you have a business that you'd like us to read copy about,
yep.
Hit us up.
Yeah, we will happily read your copy. So let's get into some MXPX news. Because we have this week, we have more new content by the band. Well, not technically by the band, but we have. So I feel like we just did literally like four episodes of Tumbledown.
Yep.
And culminating in what we thought was like, oh, we just finished up. Everything.
Right.
And then literally the day our last episode aired, even more Tumbledown was released onto Spotify. Now, it might sound like I'm saying this in an ungrateful manner.
It's great for the universe, just not as good for our brand.
Yeah, I don't know. We might have to... Are we going to have to do...
Maybe that could be like a bonus app.
A bonus app. We might have to do a bonus app. Yeah. On the Road Again, which features American Band, mm-hmm. Silver Things, and On the Road Again.
Which we only heard. Did we hear that version of On the Road Again on the show?
Yes.
Okay. But the other two we did not hear. Okay. Yeah.
Yes. And Well, the American band, I think we played, the only version that we could find was some show version.
Right. Like that video.
It was on YouTube.
Yeah.
And it was somebody taking a video of them.
Yeah.
And the audio quality wasn't great.
Right. I was saying before we started recording that I feel a little bit bad now because I was like, I don't know, why would they do this song? And this actual recorded version, like, kind of rules. They go into, like, double time at the end.
It does rule.
I'm into it.
Yep. And then Stars Will Light Your Way.
Also great.
Five song EP, which includes the Spanish version of Great Big World.
It's fun. He doesn't name the same towns. He names Mexican places.
So I tweeted at Mike and I said, essentially, like, did you write a new lyrics? And he's like, well, it's in Spanish, so it's all new words. And I was like, yeah, I know.
Understood.
I don't know Spanish, but I know enough to know it when I hear it. And so I said, I was wondering if he tried to translate the original into Spanish.
Just type it into Google.
Or if it's essentially a whole new song. Mm-hmm. And he said, listen to the next podcast. We'll answer that.
Ooh.
So.
A little tease.
Yeah.
Our podcast?
Yeah. He's.
He's going to be explaining it.
On the next episode of Magnified Pod. Mike Herrera is going to explain El Grande. I don't even know the word for world. God damn it. My Spanish is so bad.
I know it somewhere in my brain.
In your cabeza.
There you go.
So I remember hearing something like he was using...
Mundo.
Okay.
Mundo. Sorry.
I love delayed jokes. Make them even funnier.
Mundo. I'm going to drop it a third time later.
Yes. So... I thought he said, like, you know, he said Mexico. I thought I heard Tijuana in there, too.
Yeah, I forget. Just a couple towns.
Yeah. And, of course, Son of a Gun Acoustic, which that
we
song...
We don't need to do another version of that one.
Yeah, we need to... Can we listen to a 17th version of Son of a Gun?
I was pleased to see, though, looking at the, like, which songs of theirs have been the biggest listens or whatever. That,
yeah.
I think Son of a Gun is like a close number two to Let's Drink, isn't
it? At the top. Yeah. It's in the number one spot. I'm wondering
it's pretty cool.
If that means it's kind of climbing and like that has the highest climbing of, I don't know how Spotify works, but
glad people like it as much as us though.
Yeah. And like all the top songs are from the first album. I'm wondering if it's because new people are being introduced.
Yeah,
I mean, as evidenced by some of our latest voicemails, people are just being introduced now as we have been essentially in this past year. And, you know, I'm excited for anything that comes of Tumble Down in the future.
Yep. Hashtag Tumble Down Train All Aboard.
I haven't seen many people using...
That's weird.
That's super weird. Tumble Down Train, Choo Choo, All Aboard,
yes.
Next Stop, Tumble Down Station.
Let's get this going, people.
Mike Herrera is a rock god. yes, please use that specific hashtag. We will be following it. In other news, Mike has released... another cover.
Yeah.
No Cigar by Millencolin, who, if you're not familiar with Millencolin, they're a Swedish punk rock band, and he covered their song No Cigar. And I listened to Millencolin in high school. Did you ever listen to them back in the day?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
So Life on a Plate was really the only...
Okay.
Millencolin album that I listened to a lot. I listened to that album a lot back in the day. But I don't know. I somehow lost track of them.
Yeah.
For some reason. I don't know why.
I had their first couple, which Life on a Plate was like the second one or something, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Or maybe that was, yeah, second was, one. Yeah. And then I had the one with the monkeys.
Okay.
Four Monkeys. But then No Cigar was on their next record,
right,
which that song I was obsessed with in high school. I mean, I think that's like their biggest song.
Probably.
That song rules.
Yeah, it's a really great song.
But I agree that the first couple were the ones I knew the best, aside from knowing that song from the next record. So.
I thought if someone, like Bouillon was the song I was most, I thought was like one of their biggest songs, but it's not even close.
Yeah.
No Cigar crushes Bouillon.
It's a great song.
Yeah, so when I, you know, saw that this was going to be coming out, I was like, so the lead singer, Nicola, I'm not going to try and pronounce his last name, Sarkovic.
You're the one that lived over there for a while.
He's Serbian.
Oh,
but
got it.
He's so I don't really know. Anyway, Serbian names aside, he has a very unique voice.
Yeah,
a very distinct voice, and I was wondering, Mike is doing this song acoustic.
Yeah.
How is he going to, I was curious how he was going to approach the vocals of the song. And I thought he did it.
Works pretty well.
Yeah. He made his choice was really solid.
Yeah. This kind of gets back to what we were saying about, like, you want it to be kind of a transformed song when you do a cover. And he does I feel like it is very much his own stamp.
Yeah.
Of the version of the song. So.
Yeah. So, speaking of covers.
Mm-hmm.
So one would think you have two covers sort of seemingly out of nowhere in the last couple months.
What's the other one?
San Dimas High School Football Rules.
Oh, yeah, right.
So this one is an acoustic version, of course, not a full-blown music video or studio production or anything like that.
Sure.
But it leads one to think, as was brought up last week, on the cover 3, and that was asked by, I think it was Danny Leary? Danny Leary was asking. In which we didn't prepare for last week.
No, neither did he, in our defense.
No, that's true. So, what would he ask, like, in on the cover 3, his scenario was, if they were to do covers of bands that they kind of came up with, their contemporaries, if you will, who would we like to see on the cover 3? And I liked that, as opposed to just like,
just,
you know,
set of covers,
Weezer released perhaps one of the most boring covers album of all time.
Yeah.
Like, let's pick the most covered songs of all time. If I have to hear somebody else's version of Toto's Africa, I swear that they were like 15 years too late for that reaching peak of people feeling nostalgic for that song.
I don't even mind the songs they chose necessarily, although, like you're saying, they're a little uninspired. They sound note for note like the original. So I'm like, okay, cool. So it's like River Singing, but I would like, getting back to our point, I would like to hear transformed versions of the songs, put a new spin on it. And so that's the part that's disappointing to me, but it seems to have worked. It's like their biggest selling record in years, and people are into it, I guess.
Well,
but,
and then if you go again,
500 Miles is MXPX's most listened to song, which is a bummer.
So yes, cover, this goes back to our on the cover conversation. What makes a good cover?
Right.
What makes a song? Because we were alarmingly inconsistent with our reasoning. Sometimes we liked a straightforward version of a song as opposed to, but we both thought that Poison cover kicked ass.
Yeah, that was really cool.
You know, it's such a rad cover. So, you know, when it comes to an album of their contemporaries, how can you transform
right.
a punk rock song to a point where it's like something
yeah.
notably different, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't put together like a hard and fast list
okay.
of like, I had some like some thoughts, like some song ideas, not like one specific song. On some of them I have okay. like one specific song.
I put way too much thought into mine.
I love it. No, that's, I'm into it. I would like to, so do you just kind of want to trade back and forth?
Sure. Much like, Riker, AKA Strikers challenge to put together a set list. I really enjoyed this challenge. So thanks, Danny. Yeah, I did 10 songs, which I feel like sticking to 10, no more than that, is our usual right. parameter for some sort of exercise like this.
And I didn't even do 10.
Sure.
So, I mean.
Yeah. Well, okay. So, I kind of grouped them in to a few different chunks.
Okay.
And the first chunk is sort of like, there's no question that these guys are their contemporaries, and it's kind of like obvious songs, but nonetheless songs that I would like to hear their versions of. So first I had a Five Iron song.
Okay.
Fistful of Sand.
Okay.
Because I like to hear Screamy Mike. I don't know exactly what they'd do with the horns, but they could work out a little guitar part perhaps or something. But this is the one with the plastic bags of yeah. Novocaine.
Yes.
Which, you know, I would love to hear an MXPX version of that. So that's my first one.
So I put Bad Religion.
Right on.
Of course, Bad Religion came up a little earlier than them, but they
continued.
They continued and toured with, or at least played shows with, Bad Religion, and
they stole food from their dressing room.
That's true. It's one of the reasons I thought of them.
Yeah.
So one song I thought would be cool would be Generator.
That's a good idea.
That song has some really cool bass lines.
Yeah.
So I think Mike could do something really cool with that. And it would also give Tom or Chris a chance to do some shredding, because that song has some good shredding.
Yeah.
So, and it would highlight everybody in the band. Or American Jesus or Los Angeles is Burning
yeah.
would be some other cool yeah. options.
They seem like an option that if they did do a third on the cover, even without these kind of parameters, like that's probably seems likely that they would do a Bad Religion song
yeah.
at some point. Okay. I went Goaty Hook.
I mean, of course they'd have Stephen Edgerton come in from Bad Religion.
Obviously. We'll never let that joke die, and people will continue to be confused by it, except for the couple that remember what we're talking about.
Yes.
Goaty Hook was my next one.
Goaty Hook is on my list as well.
Okay, cool. I went with Middle Ground.
Okay.
Which is another screamy one. This is the, you know, the told to sit there on the couch, arms crossed with no idea. Anyway, I would like to hear the, that's on Banana Man.
It's on Banana Man.
I would like to hear the, yeah, just tearing it up. Yuri comes in here. Make that bass a little deeper and
yeah,
bigger.
This album, it doesn't have the production. It
doesn't sound great.
It doesn't sound super great. But I listened to the shit out of Banana Man back in the day.
Hell yeah.
I
just think this would be a fun, faster one for them to do.
Yep.
What was your go-to choice?
Seasons off of Sumo Surprise.
Also a great one. Did you hear a little of that?
Doesn't sound great.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. Or I did My Bike, which would be...
Sure.
What's missing from this picture?
It's just me!
Without my bike! This song kicks ass.
Yep. So, okay, so anything else to say about Goaty Hook?
No, but Potty Hook
yes.
spinoff could be coming at some point.
Yeah, we have to do...
think of a better name than that. Pod Nana Man.
The Pod!
Oh, yeah, that's right. You already suggested
this one's called The Pod.
That's already... Yes, that's what it is.
So stupid.
Food line.
Face-to-face.
Yep, I thought about them, too.
Bent but Not Broken...
Okay.
That's off of
self-titled?
God damn it. It's off their most recent record, Protection. God damn it. Why can't it?
I tuned out a while ago.
You haven't heard this?
I don't think so.
Bent But Not Broken has a sick ass, listen to this bass.
Yeah, they always have the best bass.
Surprise every time we buy the light.
Yeah, so
I was obsessed with those
Mike
first few.
Could shred the shit out of Bent But Not Broken.
Yeah, I think the one that I knew the best was the self-titled one, but
sure,
that had the walk the walk legendary bass riff, the
they came to or were coming either. We either just missed them or...
Yeah, I saw that. Pretty sure they played with our buddies much the same.
Yeah, that sounds about right. I think they played their self-titled and Ignorance is Bliss straight through.
Should have gone to that.
I know. Well, it was sold out.
Okay.
By the time I saw it, they were already all sold out. So, fuck us.
I saw them many times, but like 20 years ago. So, right. I would like to see them again.
Same. What's next for you?
What is next for me is Rancid, which seems like another obvious pick.
Got them
too. Got them on there. I went Maxwell Murder.
Okay. Oh, that's an obvious choice.
It's got that bass solo in there that like Mike just
classic.
Could obviously slay, and I would like to hear it. He's already done the Olympia
Washington. I have solo. That's on my list.
But I would like to hear Mike go, dial 999 if you really want the truck. What'd you go with?
Olympia Washington, which is actually already a legit cover that he does, or Time Bomb.
Okay.
Or anything
really
off,
any Rancid
out
song.
And out come the wolves.
Right.
I mean any
it's such a man. Yeah. Part of why preparing for this was fun was that I listened to so many of these records that I haven't heard in a long time.
Yeah.
And let me tell you, that record still rules.
Of course it rules.
Like front to back, I'm just like, oh my gosh, every song is so good.
It's so classic.
Yeah.
Newfound Glory.
Okay.
Understatement, Dress to Kill, Hit or Miss.
Okay.
Or any of those early 2000s hits.
Yeah.
So speaking of Newfound Glory and covers, they are going to be releasing their third From the Screen to Your Stereo 3.
Okay.
And just the other day, they released their cover of The Power of Love.
This is right up your alley.
It is right up my alley. So not only that, not only did they do Power of Love, which is from Back to the Future, they did a music video where... he's dressed up like Marty. There's stop motion animation.
What?
They change it enough.
Okay.
And the music video is so sick. So I just want to play a little bit of it. They got a little Marty. Drive.
That's us.
The power of love is a curious thing. Make one man weep, make another man sing. Change your heart to a little white dove.
The bass sounds so sick.
Pretty great. Reminds me a little of Ben Wyatt's REM video.
Yes, so everybody should go stop what they're pause our podcast, go watch the Newfound Glory Power of Love music video.
Yeah.
Because it's so fucking sweet.
Yeah, that's awesome.
It made me so happy. And it is criminally low in the views right now.
Boo.
It's only 88,000 views, which is, this seems like, this has everything that this music video.
I was just about to do that.
This music video has everything.
It's got stop motion animation.
And it's got
Marty McFly vest. And that thing where
a a action figure comes to life and plays guitar of your favorite music from movies from the 80s.
Well done.
No, not really. That was the worst Stefan of all time.
Well, whatever.
Whatever. We're doing what we can. Okay, so, what's your next one?
Okay, this is kind of the end of my obvious chunk, but Screeching Weasel.
Okay.
Cool Kids.
Mm-hmm.
Seems like a song they would possibly realistically cover at some point.
Sure.
But that just seems like a classic Screeching Weasel song to me. I'd like to hear the MXPX version of it.
Boom. I have Slick Shoes.
Sure.
Something from Rusty, like Feeble or Cliche or Joe's Sick, or something from Burnout, like For Better or For Worse or East on Tracks. Because East on Tracks has that, has that sick opening.
Yeah.
I mean, I could also just.
Why don't I think people prefer to hear our mouth noises. And then it's like. It's a pretty good approximation.
Squeeze!
Pod Shoes podcast coming soon.
Yep. What's yours?
Okay, so now we're branching out into stuff that's like a little more, I mean, it's still kind of in the wheelhouse, but not obvious contemporaries, I guess, but Smoking Popes.
Okay.
Need You Around. This one is one of my faves. It feels like a little bit of a stretch because, you know, Josh Cater's voice is so distinct. He's
sure.
kind of like a crooner, you know, but I would like to hear what Mike might do with that. So I would like to hear that.
Nice. So this is where I also kind of get away from the contemporaries. So, you know, we always joke about the MXPX song, Don't Walk Away, being the best U2 song of 2003. So I thought maybe they should cover Walk On from All That You Can't Leave Behind.
Yeah, I would support that.
What's
the actual cover they did on the cover two of U2's?
What was that?
I shall Google it. I will follow. Yeah. Which was great.
Yes. Yep. Yeah. I mean, I guess they already did. I didn't even remember that they did a U2 song already.
It's a pretty straightforward version. I was very into it. I would like to hear a Walk On. I feel like Mike could handle that.
Yeah. It's the... Should I do some mouth noises again?
That rolls.
Nailed it. Okay, what's your next?
Okay, so Dillinger Four.
Okay.
Who is one of my favorite bands. Double Whiskey Coke, No Ice, which is maybe their most well-known song. One of theirs. It's certainly one of my favorites of theirs. It's very kind of different sound than them, especially vocal-wise, but I would like to hear their interpretation of the D4 sound. So
boom. All right. So I was thinking if we were gonna do I was thinking contemporary, not necessarily in bands that were in the same circle but in the same region. I was thinking maybe a Nirvana song.
I thought about that as well. I was like, I guess they were kind of contemporaries for a couple of years.
Yeah.
Or a year, maybe. 94 was kind of the 1 year they overlapped.
Yeah. I was thinking like other, you know, Soundgarden or Pearl Jam. I don't know. Something, some, you know, Pacific Northwest punk grunge band.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
What song?
Territorial Pissings.
Sure.
Or I don't know.
Yeah.
Something like that. You could even do like an unplugged version.
Yeah, I was gonna say like something in the way. I could see Mike doing kind of a cool stripped down version of that or something.
Yeah,
I don't know. Very different vocal styles, those two.
That is true.
I mean, that's part of why I want to hear.
Get a little yelly Mike.
Yeah, I'm down with that. Okay, so then kind of moving into another chunk, which this feels a little more tumbledowny, and maybe it's just that I'm on that tumbledown train choo-choo, but I think hearing The Living End would be a really cool band for them to cover. Prisoner Society, which is one of their big songs, I think, from their first record, and yeah, it's just got those great guitar solos that I'd like to hear Tom do. It's got those great gang vocals. Maybe Mike could bust out the upright bass for it. But I love, I don't know, I'm going to force the tumble down sound into MXPX.
So, do it.
So that's what I got for that.
About some Descendants.
Yeah. They did do a Descendants cover, didn't they?
They did.
I want to be Stefan and Milo.
Yeah. So maybe.
But I'm not saying that doesn't mean they can't do another one.
God damn it. I keep like.
We covered on the cover too a while ago. It was a while ago.
Yeah, it's been a while ago. And it's not one of those albums that it's been a while. It's not one of those albums I especially come back to.
No, but you mentioning the Poison song did make me want to listen to that in the shower tomorrow.
That is true. Now everybody can think about John. Oh, yeah. John just listening to Poison.
Just getting all. Rocking out. Getting in all the suds.
Getting all lathery.
Yeah.
You use a loofah? You use a bar?
I just use a bar.
Use a bar? Okay.
Yeah, I'm a barman.
You're a barman. This episode of Magnified Pod is brought to you by, I don't know, what's
Loofah
a bar?
Co. Oh.
What's a bar soap
Dove?
Company? Dove. Dove Man.
Smooth as fuck.
Do your genitals need to be exfoliated? Do you got a lot of loose skin on your dick? Take care of that dick skin.
With be a real bummer of a campaign. I would advise against that.
Yes. Please do not exfoliate your penis. That sounds terrible.
Oh,
that sounds excruciating.
Right, what do you loofah it up?
I use loofah.
You loofah?
Yeah.
I can never really figure them out.
No?
I think I'm like doing it wrong. I always get like too much.
Well, it's all about the, balance.
Yeah.
You know, you gotta, it's also getting a good sponge, a good either loofah or sponge.
Sponge-worthy.
And yeah. And you know, have you been using body washes and loofahs for years now? I don't, mm-hmm. I think probably since college.
Sure.
So, I've always felt, and I don't know, I feel like a bar soap is one of those things. If I'm gonna, I don't know, like a loofah, I want to know it's mine.
Sure.
You know, like, yeah. I don't want somebody else's, you know, I don't want to be, you know, washing myself with somebody else's, you know, butt bar.
Well, my wife and I use separate bathrooms.
Okay.
Because we live in a mansion.
Yes, I forgot to tell you that this is the basement of John's. This is like
we're in the podcast wing.
Yeah, this is when we say magnified, you know, Magnified Studios West. That's like
it's the west end structure
of
the compound.
Yeah, you have to take the elevator, the freight elevator down
past the bowling alley.
And then, you know, I just wave to Jeeves as he says, "Oh, right this way, sir.
The loofah's right over here. I haven't put
Do
it in my butt.
Do you need to exfoliate your dick, sir? Do you need any assistance?" Yeah.
Oh, Jeeves.
And I say,
"You rascal.
You rascal. Please, Jeeves, I've got this under control. Please."
Oh, man.
Yeah, I don't know why I'm showering at your house.
Why not?
But
what are we talking about? Oh yeah, shower poison.
Shower.
Okay.
You're showering with poison. You're naked. Talking about Dove Men. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Back to it. Now we're back on track.
All right.
I don't have any more. I was just winging it with the Descendants.
That was good.
Yeah.
I mean, do you have a Descendants suggestion?
No.
Okay.
Cool to be you.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I think that, I mean, obviously that's right in their wheelhouse. I'm sure
American.
Yeah. they'll probably do another sentence cover at some point in life. I only have two more.
Okay.
One is a continuation of the tumble down theme, Reverend Horton Heat, which is a little bit of a cheat because it's like, again, he was around for a long time before MXPX, but he continued on through the 90s. And this is much more tumble downy than MXPX, kind of straight up a country, but Liquor, Beer, and Wine. It's such a great drinking song, and it would fit in so well with the kind of mic bar song.
Yeah.
Genre,
okay.
Subgenre.
Nice.
So I'd love to hear the MXPX or Tumble Down version of that. And then finally, and this one's the one that's like the biggest reach, Fugazi.
Okay.
Those are like very different styles.
Correct.
But a Fugazi, Five Corporations, I thought maybe they could pull that off.
Okay.
I would really like to hear an MXPX take on Fugazi. Mike doing the, this one's us, let's take another. I think that'd be really
yes.
cool.
Yep.
So anyway. That's those are my 10.
Nice. What about, I thought about this the other day, but you know, I was also thinking about, you know, when it comes to doing another On the Cover 3, the likelihood of them doing any crossover or anything with former Tooth and Nail bands is probably sure. not likely.
Probably not.
But I don't know. So I was thinking about, you know, a lot of these bands that I listened to. That's like Ace Troubleshooter was another one that I thought of. You know, Tonight or Denise or anything like that.
Denise. There were a bunch of bands that I thought of that ultimately I was just like kind of went back to. I feel like an MXPX version of it would just be pretty much the same.
Yeah.
So I kind of tried to steer away from those, but even still, Mike's vocals would be different from
those bands. Dude, I didn't realize that Ace Troubleshooter was from Minneapolis.
We talked about it on the pod before, bro.
Did we? you know that I never remember anything we talk about.
Nor do I. I only remember this one because, you know, Minneapolis.
Plymouth, Minnesota.
Yeah, not the Twin Cities.
Yeah, they're... I mean, it's pretty much like somebody saying like, oh, yeah, we're from Chicago, Arlington Heights.
Palatine.
But...
where we are right now.
Yep. Then there was a Value Pack was another...
Yeah, I thought about
another
that.
One I thought of. Anyway, so that's for you, Danny Leary.
Let us know, Danny, yours, and listeners, what you would like to hear. I don't know that I need another MXPX on the cover, but I do like this idea of kind of like putting some parameters on it. And I'm kind of like into this idea of them doing some of these covers of their contemporaries that we haven't heard. So I'm curious about what other people would like to hear.
Agreed. Hey, so why don't we go to some voicemails?
Do it.
We have a... first time, long time.
Brian Anderson here from California. First time, long time. First saw MXPX heard of MXPX, Magnified Pod, Pokinatcha. In the early years, that was probably early 1995. It was, you know, typical Christian family, not allowed to listen to any other kind of music. Mm-hmm. Found this really cool record label, Tooth and Nail. I think I bought that first sampler they had, which was a red sampler at the same time. Had like a punk rock show. I think it was an MXPX song on there. Had a whole bunch of cool people, Wonderhead and Savannah Rail Company and Blank Eye. Fell in love with MXPX. I loved that first album. Listened to it forever, over and over and over again. Listen to it now. It's a little rough, but it's very nostalgic. I like a lot of kids our generation, it was like got me into music. It's punk rock became the thing that I was about. Loved it. Loved your guys' podcast. MagPod for life. Bye.
Thanks, buddy.
Thanks, Brian.
We have so many Brys now.
We do. We have so many Bryans. Man, it's
spying them all with my eye.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that what I said?
You're like, yeah. I don't know.
I appreciate any Study Humans reference, okay?
Always.
So I was thinking about, I mean, this is sort of getting back to what we talked about in our original episode.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of our origin stories and,
sure.
you know, what we could and couldn't listen to. And,
yeah.
and I felt like I put my own parameters on myself, you yeah. know, like, you know, Brian was saying, he's like, kind of like grew up in a Christian household as like we both did.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, listening to only Christian music. And you didn't put that parameter on yourself. Because as you said, the Adrenalize was your first CD.
Yeah, so I was godless from an early age.
You
just wanted to get rocked.
You wanted to make love like a man.
Yeah, I did. I was a little boy and I just wanted to make love like a man.
Make love like a man.
Should have put Def Leppard in there.
I'm a man.
Covers.
Yeah, that is true. They should have. What would be MX? What would MXPX cover?
I mean, Pour Some Sugar on Me would be like the obvious one.
Rocked?
But Let's Get Rocked. I mean, that's what I want
to
hear.
I would love to hear Tom do the intro. Do you want to get rocked?
Oh man, yeah. I'm trying to picture Mike doing that one. It would be something.
He'd turn into a dog, and then like
oh, boy.
He'd be like, "Fuck classical music,
that ain't my scene."
Anyway, so yeah, I was we're gonna get into the I don't want to get ahead of myself.
Sure.
You know, Brian's voicemail was making me think about a lot of the tweets that we got about when people first discovered Pokinatcha.
I feel like opening up the Pokinatcha question mailbag again, pointed out how many listeners of ours saw them like super early on, which is awesome. I mean, it's cool, Brian, that you saw them so early. I'm sure we tried to nail down.
It's hard.
What year we first saw them? I think it was 98 or 99 for me.
For me,
it was not
95. It was 2000 for me.
Okay, right on.
That was the earliest. It was right before Ever Passing Moment came out.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay.
We were also, you know, little boys and wanted to be big boys.
That's true.
You know, people who had a few years on us. They got in while the getting was good, you know?
Yeah. I mean, seeing them, I kept, like, asking people, like, well, tell me more. Because, like, seeing them in 94, like,
yeah.
that's a specific subset of people who were able to do that. So I wanted all the details. But
yeah, if you lived in the Pacific...
If
you lived in the Pacific Northwest, I turned into Madea there for a second. So yeah, if you lived in Washington or that area or California, the chances of seeing MXPX at the time,
you
was greatly increased. Of course, they toured their asses off. So,
right.
I didn't discover them until, you know, eighth grade, which would have been 97 maybe. Because it must have been 97 because I started.
You start with Life in General.
Teenage Politics. Do you remember this podcast?
As we said, very vaguely.
Yeah.
But didn't we?
I started with Teenage Politics, went Life in General,
right.
and then back to.
But was Life in General out when you got Teenage Politics?
Yes.
It was already out.
Okay. Yes.
I'm just trying to remember the timeline.
Yeah, I think I must have picked up Teenage Politics probably because either it was a song I had heard on a sampler or
right.
something.
Your
or
friend
maybe,
had it or something.
Or the cover
yeah.
struck me or something.
You like the cover.
I don't really remember specifically why I would have picked out that album.
Did you ask for Life in General for Christmas
yes.
after that?
I asked for Life in General for Christmas and got on the cover.
Right.
This is well-traveled road. Well-traveled ground. And I'm still bitter about it.
My grandma got me Life in General for Christmas, and that was right around the it came out not long before, and I had Teenage Politics already. Anyway, who cares? I saw them on the Buffalo tour. That was the first time. It was great.
Let's just start the whole podcast over. We're just gonna cover all the albums again. Nothing makes sense anymore. let's hit up somebody that we haven't heard from in a while.
Hello, my dudes. This is your boy Nikki P. This is a redo voicemail. Because apparently my voicemail skills at first were Danny Stairs level. Burn! But haven't called in a while, just because I've been busy and I've been catching up on the sweet content. What am I thinking? Oh, so some things. Yeah, I'm really pissed off that everyone's going to this MXPX show and I won't be there.
You should come.
Damn, dude,
and,
it sucks.
You know, I'm super jealous. And I just want to fucking be there and get, you know, listen to punk rock show, you know, all that good stuff. But I'll miss you guys. You guys are going to have a bunch of fun. Speaking of that, I was reminded of Riker just making a whole trip out of it and going to Austin. Just a suggestion for you, my guy. You need to check out the Bat Bridge. Bridge is this thing in Austin. You go there, and every night at dusk, like tens of thousands of bats just fly. Freaking sweet. So you need to do that. And what else am I talking about? Well, you guys had mentioned the whole rehabilitate people in society with, like, politicians and then Tim from As I Lay Dying. And I am not one to separate the artist from the art. I see art as more of, like, an extension as oneself, or even as career as an extension and all that stuff, and actions that, you know, that pour into other parts of other people's lives. So... I think that there's room for rehabilitation, but I think there needs to be boundaries. Like, a politician is doing blackface. They probably don't need to be a public leader anymore, possibly. Mm-hmm. If someone's, like, a child molester, they probably shouldn't be with kids. And then Tim probably shouldn't be, you know, a fucking marriage counselor. So,
it's fair.
There needs to be rehabilitation, but with boundaries, I think. So that's just, you know, that's just my two cents. Anyways, also the fucking merch. What the fuck? I'm so freaking excited. Post those bitches really quick because they'll be gone by me. I'm buying you guys up, buying your whole stock. Keeping it all for myself out of spite for not being at the punk rock show. Anyway, Magnified Pod for life. Many smooches. Peace.
Thanks, buddy.
Thanks, Nikki P. It's always a genuine pleasure. I just want to check. Did he say Magnified Fod?
I didn't hear that, but it's possible.
Magnified Fod.
Could be.
We'll take
acceptable.
We'll take Magnified Fod.
That's when we finally get our pies from Anchor Valley Wine.
Exactly.
We'll start selling Magnified.
Still waiting on those pies, bros.
Yeah, come on.
Where's our Pinot? Our Pinot pie.
Yes, we're going to work with the finest pie and wine vendors to create the Magnified Fod Pinot Pie coming 2019.
We'll sell it at the store. We'll put it into a box, nice and hot, piping hot, right out of the oven. It'll come to you spoiled, it'll make our best effort. So I want to talk about a couple things. Nikki P, our hearts will break every moment that you're not there.
We'll sneak you in. Come on.
Come on. Dude, we know some people.
Yeah.
We'll be like, hey, this is our fucking guy. It's Nick Polk. You don't fucking know Nick Polk? This fucking guy. That's how.
Hey.
That's how. It's
get
done.
The fuck out of here.
This fucking guy.
We I mean, we've all seen the Let's Ride video. We know how to sneak in the back door.
That's true. You just distract, knock on the door, hide behind a dumpster.
Yeah, call it
the guy. The guy checks his phone like an idiot, and you sneak in. He gets pissed. This is their Mike and company are basically encouraging people to sneak into shows and
Magnified Fun.
The sneak into shows and steal from bands. That's basically what he's telling us to do.
Yeah. Your fault, bro.
Yeah, your fault. It's on you. That's on you. But the other thing, the rehabilitating people, mm-hmm. I feel like we rushed through a lot of it last time trying to talk about a lot of those issues, but making a good point that boundaries are important. So I think what Tim is trying to do right now, Tim Lambesis, who tried to hire somebody to murder his estranged wife, he's working in areas that relate to violence and addiction. So trying to work from his own experience, mm-hmm. Which makes sense. So yeah, maybe him trying to, to your point, boundaries I think are good. And the fewer white supremacists in government, the better.
Sure.
That's what I always say.
Yeah. I mean, it's all complex and I appreciate
it. Except for the white supremacy part.
No, I know. But I mean, I guess you could say if somebody wore blackface in college and regrets it, does that make you white supremacist? I'm not saying
No, I don't think it makes.
But I'm also not saying it's okay to do that. So
no, I don't know. It's never. Did you see that SNL sketch about it was Kenan Thompson he was holding a press conference with like all these different people in the government and they all wore blackface and they're like, but like, what if you were just doing it as like part of the costume? They're like, no,
still not.
But like, what if, and they were all coming up with these, and he's like, no, don't.
Right.
It's not.
Yeah.
You don't do it.
No, I appreciate what he said about boundaries. And I think, one thing that we didn't touch on as much with the Tim Lambesis thing that maybe I didn't realize was like, he was in the throes of what he now identifies as like mental illness and serious drug addiction. And like those things can cloud your judgment to the point of doing something that crazy. So
yeah,
I think like
he was doing like a bunch of steroids and stuff.
Right, right,
so,
right.
Anyway. It's none of these are to excuse anything.
Yeah.
These are all abhorrent decisions that people make.
Yeah.
But it's and then there's also, of course, privilege aspects, which I think we tried to bring up quickly. And like we didn't do any of it justice because there's that's also a super weighty issue.
Yeah.
Anyway, how about we go to some Danny Leary.
Hey, this is Danny Leary, and I'm calling with the question of the week about Pokinatcha. I don't remember exactly my first experience listening to Pokinatcha, but I do remember the mindset with which I listened to it, because I've talked about this before, but basically before I eventually found MXPX, I'd been listening to like MTV Grunge for the previous 3 years, and I was used to this idea that I was used to the phenomenon that when you get into a band that's like now selling, a ton of albums like Nirvana or Green Day or something like that, that you go back and you listen to their first album and it's not as polished and it's probably not going to be as satisfying when you're a teenage kid looking for that like perfect musical experience. So I'd already learned that through other bands that I ultimately wasn't going to love as much as MXPX in the end. So when I discovered Teenage Politics and life in general, I was like, well, I gotta go back and check out Pokinatcha. But I was already prepared for the idea that it was probably going to be a rougher experience because I'd already had that experience with other bands. So when I heard it, I was like, yep, it's rougher. But somehow, almost like all your relationships lead to, hey, they help improve your next relationship. Like having that relationship with bands where I knew older albums aren't as good as newer ones when you're a kid, especially before the internet, and you just have to spend your money and hope that the CD you're going to listen to is good. I was prepared psychologically for Pokinatcha to be rough around the edges, so I really loved it for what it was. And then ultimately, I didn't really get into hardcore punk. Like, I didn't even like metalcore and like harder music until way later, like by college. So I could actually go back to Pokinatcha and enjoy the sort of aggression and the muddy guitars a lot better now that I like harder music. So that's kind of my thoughts on that. Magpod for life.
Thanks, bud.
Thank you for that. Why did I say that like an asshole?
And thank you for that.
Thanks a lot, asshole. So I think that is a... This experience is something that nobody will ever have to deal with again. I'm just going to have to throw money at this album and hope it's good.
Yeah.
You know, we talked about that in the earlier episodes and how you had to especially in the era of soundtracks, it's like the soundtrack has the one song that you could only get on that one soundtrack.
Yep.
And so you have to buy it like an asshole and just like, I need to get the City of Angels soundtrack.
I was thinking the exact same thing.
To get this one goddamn Alanis Morissette song.
Hi.
So good though.
Nailed it. But I think that's smart that he's like, he learned. He's like, okay, I'm going to take what I've learned from this and apply it to MXPX and see if the theory holds up.
Yeah.
And it does. But, so that's
I think my main takeaway from that is we got another Pokinatcha.
We do.
Pronouncer.
We do. I am fascinated by this as well because Riker... He self-corrected.
He's like, nervous.
I don't know why I said Pokinatcha. I don't say Pokinatcha. Because one would assume that Pokinatcha is poking at you.
Well, it's based on the Snickers campaign.
Pokinatcha, Pokinatcha.
They said at the time hunger was Pokinatcha.
Yeah. Famously from the... Paula Poundstone sketch.
Oh, okay. That's what you're doing right now. Got it.
What's that?
That's the Pokinatcha, Pokinatcha.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, long about noon.
Right.
When your appetite's Pokinatcha, Pokinatcha.
Right. Okay.
And yeah, do you not know that?
I don't know that, but now I guess I got to find it.
Oh, it's fucking classic. the whole bit is, so Paula Poundstone, who I'm seeing...
I was going to say.
...in a couple months in Skokie.
Wait, did you see her at Wait? Did that already happen?
Oh, no.
She wasn't there.
I've been wanting to see her at Wait for so long, and when Dana and I went to Wait, Don't Tell Me, the NPR news quiz, it was not Paula, and
who was there?
It doesn't matter.
Okay. Did anybody exciting call in?
William Shatner.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, he was the guest, and Peter Sagal is a huge Star Trek fan.
Yeah. Okay.
So
I could see that.
The part that wasn't aired was him like sort of freaking out and just like watching him react to things, but also that you should go back and people should listen. If you're not familiar with Wait, Don't Tell Me, it's a syndicated program, so people around the country should know it.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's a great episode. And what were we talking about?
Paula Poundstone.
So her whole bit is that that no matter how dumb something is, somebody wrote it down on a piece of paper.
Okay.
And so she's like that old Snickers commercial where the woman's like brushing a horse, and someone interrupts her to ask what time of day she enjoys Snickers. And she says, oh, you know, long about noon when your appetite's poking at you. And she's like, someone wrote that down on a piece of paper, and probably a couple of times, too.
Good point.
And that there are people who auditioned for that commercial
right.
and were turned down and became bitter.
Yeah.
Paul Poundstone's a genius.
I agree, Danny, that you have to contextualize Pokinatcha, as we'll get into, but I love it for what it is too. It's interesting. We'll get into this when we get some of our QOT dubs comments. But people seem to kind of be of two minds about it. It's either like, this sounds like garbage and the songs are mostly garbage, or like, it's great. It's like, for what it is, kind of. And right. I think I always liked it. I mean, I'm one of the MXPX fans who got bitter when they got popular, which is like a lot of people's favorite iteration of the band.
Right.
So I think I always clung to that early stuff as being like evidence of their pure punkness and their punk cred.
Right.
Even going back and listening to it, it's not their strongest. It doesn't have a lot of variation, as we've talked about. But I love it because it's like, it is pure punk rock in a way that none of their other stuff is.
But it's also honest.
Yeah.
You know, this was Mike in the early days of him learning to write.
Right.
He was writing and writing and writing.
A million songs.
And, you know, they got signed to Tooth and Nail. He had like 100 songs or something like that. And, you know, he's a machine. Yep. And the recording, it's not the best. As we've talked about before, it's too long.
Right.
Some of the songs could have used a producer's ear.
Sure.
And learn, like, you know, a Kravakian style ear, where they're like, no, lose the fill.
Yeah.
You know, cut out this additional, you know, chorus or verse or whatever.
Yeah. Breakdown.
You know, just tighten it up.
Hashtag get Kravak back.
Yeah, hashtag Kravak back. You know, but, you know, I don't listen back to this and think, you know, sometimes when I think about, like, we all want a band to continue to produce what they want to produce, because at the end of the day, this is, you know, Mike and the band, this is the way an artist... How I'm not going to tell an artist how to create. Sure. I'm not going to tell Mike how to write a song. That's stupid. But I also, you know, don't understand artists who want to completely distance themselves from their old material.
Yeah.
I understand that for an artist that's like, okay, I played this song like a floppity jillion times, and they're excited about the new stuff. They want to talk about the new stuff. That 100% makes sense to me. But you know, like it's part of who you are. It's part of the story.
Yeah.
It's part of the band's story. It's part of our individual stories. And we're so deeply connected to these songs.
Yeah.
And you know, yeah, maybe there's some cringy moments. Like, for God's sake, I played some of my shitty songs on this pod. I know they're bad, but I play them because it's part of my story. And we all went through that, you know? For anybody who's a songwriter or an artist or something, our earlier work is not always going to be the pinnacle of our creativity, but it's part of our journey.
Right.
And I don't think it should be so easily thrown out, you know?
Yeah.
Not saying that MXPX is doing that or Mike is doing that, but sure. You know, I think, you know, I still think there's value.
Yeah, some people disagree. Their manager, perhaps being one of them.
Yes, sure. Yep.
I know. Yeah, there are strong feelings about the first couple records, and I will defend them. And others who love the band dearly, really love Ever Passing Moment way more than either of those two, and that's not me at all. So
no, it's not me. You know, but even still, like, I think I had. I'm getting emotional. I think I had Pokinatcha at.
I think you had it at eight, and I had it at seven.
Yeah. So, but it's also when we also have to we looked at it objectively, you know.
Yeah. Right.
But anyway, I digress. Before you know, we have one more voicemail that I want to play before we get into actually talking about. Pokinatcha and the album and
do some question of the week action too.
That's what we're gonna do. We're okay, gonna cool, get right cool. into that. But we have it wouldn't be an episode of MagPod without a little Danny Stairs.
Of course not.
Hey, what's up, guys? Your boy Danny Stairs calling. Just you know, it's a random Tuesday night. Had a couple drinks and thinking about you guys as you know I'm wont to do. And I wrote a story I meant to share. I don't know, ages ago at this point. So I got this cousin who I grew up with in my age. He and I were big into MXPX back in the day. And he got a little more Jesus than me, I suppose. would be one way of looking at it. Grew up to be a weird dude, Baptist pastor for a little bit. He's a so-called missionary, but I've never known him to go on a trip. I think it's just a scam to get money from family. But in any event, dude is like, I was talking to him maybe last year, and he's like, oh, I'm moving to Florida. Oh, I should share. He has a wife and like six kids, and you know they homeschool, obviously. You know who they are just by that. But in any event,
Quiverfold maybe, Quiverfold, yeah. Maybe one of those populate the earth with my specific kind of right. theology babies.
Yeah, could be.
He's like, oh, yeah, we're moving to Florida. We're going to open a coffee.
So anybody who's like, yeah, we're moving to Florida, that
red flag
should be a red flag on its own.
We're going to open a coffee shop. I'm like, oh, that's cool. He's like, yeah, it's going to be down in St. Augustine. He's like, you should come down and visit sometime. I'm like, oh, yeah, that's cool. Florida's nice. No one touched the business, but, you know, whatever. So he's like, yeah, it's going to be a Christian coffee shop. I'm like, oh, that's cool. You know, like, you like, maybe have some, like, Christian gifts or whatever available, play some Christian music, you know, maybe have an occasional, like, Christian artist playing live or whatever. He's like, yeah, we're just, we're working on getting stuff all together. You know, we got our bean stores, and we found a storefront, blah, blah, blah. He's like, yeah, now all we got to do is write up the track. I'm like, oh, my God.
Amazing.
I'm like, no. No, I'm not going there. So apparently tracks are still a thing. I didn't know it. I haven't seen one. I haven't seen any like pushing a track since I was, I was in the short pants still. So I thought it was interesting. I thought you guys would be interested to know that apparently there are those probably only within the Baptist movement. I don't know who else would do it. That still think tracks are like a good thing and that people are going to want them at their coffee shop. And in any event, that was, I just wanted to share that. I've been meaning to share that for probably a couple of months. It's been in and out of my mind. And I knew you were the kind of guys who would appreciate that. So, all right, MagPod for life, guys. Love you.
So, anybody who appreciates simplified theology in cartoon form, it's us.
Yeah, I think we covered tracks on our last episode, didn't we?
We did. I think that's why he was bringing it up. The tract with Jesus spanking a girl with no pants on.
It's a tough one.
Super tough.
Look.
I showed that to Dana and she was like, no.
Why?
She's like super bummed out. It's like, yeah. Why?
That was...
Why? Also, to go back to that Paula Poundstone bit for a moment. this was something that somebody sat down and actually drew. Like, if you think about it, like, we know it exists because we can look at it.
Right.
But to think that, like, somebody's like, hey, you know, I got this idea of Jesus spanking the girl, but hear me out. What if she didn't have any pants on? You know, somebody floated that idea,
yeah.
And then somebody put pen to paper to create that image.
Yeah.
It's so fucked up.
Yeah, I gotta read some profiles of who these tract illustrators were. I'm picturing old men, but maybe I'd be surprised.
You know, old men sitting in their dark offices, wringing their hands over Catholics.
Yeah.
Ooh, these damn Catholics. While they are drawing pictures of old men touching young children.
Yikes. Well, good luck to your cousin, Dan.
Yes.
My mom lives near St. Augustine, and I can attest that it's a cool spot.
You know, notwithstanding the Christian coffee shop scene,
sure,
which we both have experience with.
Indeed.
It can be interesting, as mm-hmm. you talked about, bring in maybe some Christian bands.
Yeah.
It can also bring about some questionable stuff.
Indeed.
Such as tracks.
Right.
Which are, in my opinion, not always the best.
Yeah.
Because you're essentially trying to, in the quickest way possible, get your message across in maybe a manipulative way.
Sure.
And if you're doing it in a cartoon form, you're appealing to children.
Right.
Usually.
Yeah.
So.
Shitty cartoon form.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's never good art.
No, it's not. And if you're you know, want to look at, you know, the Jack Chick style of art,
mm-hmm.
It's almost always very basic and thrown together.
Yep.
But let's not spend another episode talking about tracks.
Jack Chick, our next guest on the pod, we can announce now.
He's dead.
The ghost of Jack Chick.
The ghost of Jack Chick. We are going to be resurrecting him to talk about why he was so terrible.
And a twist, he's actually in hell. So didn't work out.
Joke's on you. So anyway, let's... I don't want to spend any more time talking about Jack Chick.
No, another thing about Jack Chick that I love.
Here's the thing. You and I love about Jack Chick? Nothing.
Everything.
So, should we use this time to get into our question of the week segment, or should we lump that in with our?
We could lump it in. Maybe we need a little break, a little breather,
a little breather. Let's do that, and then we'll just lump in the question of the week with the album section. So when we come back, we're going to poke at it.
Yeah, we are.
A little bit. Or we're going to poke otch it.
Yeah, we're going to poke at it.
We're going to poke in ot the album and the question of the week.
Mm-hmm.
And we're back.
Yeah, we are.
That's a song about Jesus.
Like many of
these
songs.
And we just started it like that. So this is going to be the Pokinatcha section of the pod.
Indeed.
We are going to get into the QOTWs, the question of the week. Which we don't do every week, but
is
we do.
Is the answer in the question?
Is the answer in the question?
I think it is.
Okay.
I have to check, though.
Okay.
It is. Okay. The answer is in the question.
Cool, cool, cool.
So the question of the week was, when did you get introduced? When did you first hear Pokinatcha? Which is not too far off. What was your first introduction to the album Pokinatcha? What did you think then? What are your thoughts on the album now? So, John, what was your... Can you remember... I mean, we just sort of were trying to think back to it in the previous segment, but do you have any... Do you know where you got it from?
I believe what I said in the episode that I didn't listen to the first part of.
I didn't listen to it either.
I got Teenage Politics first.
Yes.
Clear on that much.
Yes.
It was before Life in General came out, just before. And I was excited about that. And then I must have... I feel like I got Pokinatcha after Life in General even. And I knew about it. But I was obsessed with those two records, obviously. And then I wanted to go back and be a completist. I'm sure I got it before Buffalo.
100%.
But I got it used. I know that much. Sorry, guys. And mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I'm like Danny in that I knew its reputation as a little...
Danny Leary.
Harder edged and rougher. But I was into it like immediately. It did not grab me or, you know, stay at the level of rotation of Teenage Politics or Life in General. But I was always a fan. I thought it was cool that it was... this kind of darker, grimier, more hardcore version of the band.
I think I'm in the same ballpark in that I 100 had Teenage Politics, Life in General, and then went back to Pokinatcha. I remember having a memory of listening to it in my family room, like on like a portable CD player. And looking through the lyrics booklet and just sort of like taking it all in and listening and especially feeling like that unopposed, that opening riff really felt like this is super different.
Yeah.
This sounds like a super different band.
Yeah.
And it, as we talked about on that, our first episode, just how metally it sounded. But I don't want to just rehash the same stuff from the first episode.
No.
But one thing I wanted to, and this is, you talked about how you spend a lot of time on the cover three list. Mm-hmm. I spent a lot of time today trying to look up the name of the specific Christian bookstore in Randhurst Mall.
Oh, yeah. Still go to that movie theater.
Oh, do you? Yeah. So the Randhurst, I think it's called Randhurst Village now.
That sounds right. Wasn't that fancy back then?
No. It was a kind of a shitty mall. So Randhurst now is super, super nice. Mm-hmm. And back in the day, not so much. So I was like trying to plumb the depths of my memory to remember, like I remember like the setup of the store.
Right.
You walk in and to the right was the desk of like where you check out. And it was the far straight ahead, far back wall was where it had all like the Christian alternative music. Uh-huh. And so what I had to do is I went to the Wayback Machine looked up Randhurst Mall and I like looked through the different store names and I came up with Limestone Books.
That sounds vaguely familiar.
And it's like, this is the closest I could think. And like, I'm like, that had to be it. So, Limestone Books had to have been because it was a Christian bookstore in the mall.
Yeah.
And so that's where I got any number of my albums, not Teenage Politics for sure, but I am almost certain that I got Pokinatcha at Limestone Books in Randhurst Mall.
Yeah.
And to Brian's point in the first segment, he was talking about those sampler CDs. Uh-huh. He said it was a red one. I don't know if it was like a Songs from the Penalty
That's
Box.
That's what I assumed.
Or one of those early Tooth and Nail samplers. But I definitely had some of those, and I'm pretty sure I got. Did you ever do like the harder side, the softer side, those samplers?
I don't think so.
I'm trying to. It was either. I'm gonna.
No, I want to know about it.
I can't remember if it was BEC or Cheapskates was what they were. They were like super. Yeah, it was Tooth and Nail.
Okay.
So they had. It's called Cheapskates. They were, I think they maybe said like $1.99 or something on it.
Who we got on there?
So we got some Project 86,
sure.
Furthermore, Staves Acre, Slick Shoes, Blindside, Deadlines, Shorthanded, Hangnail, Zao, Goaty Hook, Element 101, Living Sacrifice, Off the Record, AP2, The Huntingtons, The Undecided, Self-Mind Dead, The Dingies.
Gotta say, I haven't heard of a fair amount of these.
No? I had this record, so
What's
Squad 5-0, Training for Utopia, and Soup the Chemist.
Good old Soup the Chemist.
Yeah.
What was the MXPX song on it?
I don't know.
This one didn't have it.
This one didn't have it. This was, I was just thinking the, this was the kind of stuff that I remember picking up at at the Christian bookstore.
I don't know that I ever actually bought any album from a Christian bookstore.
Interesting.
We had this embarrassment of riches of great record stores in the Twin Cities, and like I said, I was a little boy, and I would ride my bike to Cheapo, and I'm 100% confident that I got Teenage Politics and Pokinatcha from Cheapo in St. Paul. So why go drop what was always way more money at the Christian bookstore
for a record fair.
Than get it used at Cheapo?
That is 100% fair. I don't think any of these Cheapskates had any MXPX. The Cheapskates softer side had some Plank Eye, had Joy Electric.
Okay.
Juliana Theory.
Sure.
And then like it had a bunch of BEC, had a bunch of like, these were like most, I think this softer side was all BEC stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So got a lot of really unique and kind of weird stuff that I wasn't into.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't really into Starflyer 59 as a kid.
Sure.
Shoegaze. Really wasn't my jam.
Yeah. I was like them, but not super into them.
Yeah.
And then, of course, Headphones, which was Dave Bazan's, one of his post-Pedro offshoots was him and the dude from Starflyer. So That was right my
Jason Martin.
Yes. Or the other Martin? Jason Martin.
No, Jason Martin was Ronnie dude, is so. Joy Electric. This is about Pokinatcha.
Right, Pokinatcha.
This is Pokinatcha.
The Martin Brothers pod is coming.
Yes.
Later.
So let's look at some of the stuff that people were saying about Pokinatcha. So why don't we start with let's start with like a pop song. So he said that Life in General was his intro to MXPX. Didn't like Pokinatcha for years because it didn't sound anything like Life in General.
Sure.
Now I love Pokinatcha for that very same reason.
That's cool.
Yeah, I think as a kid when you're younger, your first introduction, that's like what you think the band should sound like, and any deviation from that.
Sure.
Starts to be like, you know, you're in rough territory for our our stupid child brains.
It's funny how, like, going back and hearing something that was different felt okay, but, like, going forward when they would vary from that format, I was less okay, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like, and maybe it's because when they were older albums, it was harder edged, and as they would release newer stuff, it got poppier. But I wonder if the sound of Pokinatcha was the record that followed Life in General for some reason, if I would have been, like, into it, if right. I would have been like, what are they doing? I don't know. Anyway.
I feel like if they went more hard, I don't think I would have had a problem.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
Pete Rose, Pete from Texas. Mm-hmm. I heard it from a friend the day after it was released. I went out and bought it that day. I saw them live a few months later. It was amazing then, and I still really like it today. I've listened to Pokinatcha thousands of times over the years, and it never gets old.
I assume that is Pete Rose, the baseball player.
Yes.
Writing in.
Yeah.
He's a huge big Pokinatcha head.
He's a yeah. big MXPX head. So we both asked him almost simultaneously yeah. where he saw them.
We needed more information.
Yeah, we jumped on that. Like,
what the fuck?
Dude, this is like that Jen Mandigo voicemail where she was just like, and I think,
right.
when she was talking about,
meeting Andrea.
Andrea. Or, yeah. She was like, oh, she's just working at the table.
Like, we need more information.
What the hell? Jen?
Yeah.
So Pete says he doesn't remember where the first show was or who played with them sometime in late 94, early 95, and thinks it was the first Tooth and Nail weekend. The second time was October 26th, 1995 in Arlington, Texas. A local band called Gliston opened, and he says he's seen MXPX 25 to 30 times since then, pretty much every time they have come to Texas.
That's hardcore.
Yep.
Pete from Texas, we salute you.
We salute you.
For that good story.
So Gene Everett, his buddy Dave.
Right on. No further information
no
needed.
No further. We also salute Dave.
Yeah. Way to go, Dave.
Thanks, Dave. We all need a Dave.
Yeah.
In our life.
To introduce some early hardcore records.
Carrie Merriweather got my copy shortly after seeing them at New Song Coffee House.
There you go. Some tracks available.
There
perhaps.
We go. And Youth Center in Port Orchard back in like 94. Literally listened to it daily and introduced all my friends to MXPX. I loved it. We all need a Carrie Merriweather in our
yeah.
life.
I mean, seeing them in 94 at a coffee
yeah.
shop.
Oh my God.
That's pretty that's good. MXPX grad.
That's legit AF. And then we have some Jen Mandigo.
These are my favorite comments.
I got it at a record store in California at the same time Life in General came out. Teenage Politics was my intro at MXPX. Honestly, I didn't like Pokinatcha much then, and I still don't like it now.
I don't like that part.
No. And I said, controversy. And she said, it sounds like it was recorded in a garbage can. I'm not wrong.
Yeah.
So.
Fair enough.
Fair enough. I mean, we can get into the sonics of the record.
Yeah.
But, I mean, there are times in the record where I feel like it sounds okay. Anywhere But Here is a rough opening track.
Yeah. It's long. We'll get there.
It is a long album.
Twitter.
We got some tweets. Tweet at us at Magnified Pod.
That was another funny thing from the first episode. Is the only thing we plugged was our Twitter.
That's true.
That hasn't exactly
no
taken us to the stratosphere. So.
No, it's not. It has not. Pop Punk Pete's podcast.
Yeah.
I honestly didn't hear anything from that album until I heard the MXPX live album at the show.
Which we said featured Walking By.
Yes.
And One Ad.
Right? Yeah, it had at the show featured Time Brings Change.
Okay.
Walking By. One Ad. And
that might be it, right?
I think that's it. Yeah.
But still, like, that's a decent Pokinatcha showing.
Yeah. It's not bad. And so then I said, did you think I need to find these songs immediately? And he said, yes. I wondered, where are these songs from? So, Jacob Brinken, my first MXPX album was Teenage Politics. Boom. Absolutely loved it. Went back, bought Pokinatcha, and didn't really like it. Didn't listen to it much then, and don't now.
Your last, buddy.
This seems to be the people who discovered Teenage Politics first. They're like, what else is there?
Yeah.
Moonheads Unite.
That's right.
Who else needed, you know, when you hit the peak.
That's right.
Of the MXPX sphere.
Yeah.
You know.
You just need more.
Just need more. Peak. Yeah. James Roberts said, had a sample cassette called Seltzer from my church store.
I need more information about that, by the way.
Yeah, I do. I do too. Had the song Teenage Politics on it. Then discovered Pokinatcha, and the rest is history. Damn right, bro. Tyler Chamberlain says, it was my first introduction to the band at 12 years old. Next was at the show, which took me by surprise. Pokinatcha is in my top three MXPX albums. See, this is what's interesting to me, and which is why I'm glad we're doing this again.
Yeah.
People are all over the place with this record.
Yeah, it's true.
And it doesn't necessarily mean... It doesn't necessarily mean, like, if you discovered it around the time it came out, that you automatically love it.
Yeah.
Because some people, like... Jen Mandigo, she's an OG fan, and she's not
having
super,
it.
She's not super into it. You have some people who, you know, discovered, you know, maybe around 95 as well, and they're just like, eh, not feeling it.
Yeah.
So, not every MXPX fan has amazing taste. I guess is what we're saying.
Not as good as us.
Our taste is perfect.
It's true.
One hundo.
Breaking news.
Yes.
Seltzer,
uh-huh,
colon, modern rock to settle your soul.
Jesus Christ.
Was released in 1996 by Forefront Records.
Okay.
Do you remember them?
I do not.
They had, well, they still have Toby Mac.
Oh.
They had some biggies. Audio Adrenaline.
Yeah. Okay.
Bleach, DC Talk.
Sounds right.
Kevin Max, pretty much all the DC Talk guys. Rebecca St. James. I'm Rebecca St. James, and I'm a virgin. per
Andy Verdecchio's
impression. I don't know that I can.
I'm Rebecca St. James, and I'm a virgin.
I was not familiar with that that introduction that she apparently used to give, but that I have that burned into my brain now. Skillet was on there. Anyway, this compilation did feature Teenage Politics, as he said. Also, Poor Old Lou, makes sense. Supertones, sure. But then it's like Newsboys, Jars of Clay, Third Day, DC Talk, PFR. We've talked about PFR, haven't we?
I don't know if we have.
PFR.
Which song? Goldie's Last Day?
No, I don't. I think this must have been pre-Goldie. Let's see. What did I just say? Garden? Maybe that is on that record.
I
feel like I had whatever record had that and Goldie's Last Day.
I wonder if it was their first album.
Could be.
No, it was not on their first album.
Them is the record that it's on.
Them. So, Goldie's Last Day, Goldie's Great Last Lengths, Day. And Them. I had Goldie's all Last three Day. Of those records. I was into PFR.
I have not heard them in literally probably 20 years, but
or them. More.
No, well, yes, but PFR. But Goldie's Last
but
Day, I was...
You've heard them? PFR?
Is this a who's on first situation?
Third base!
Yeah. I did really like that record a lot at the time.
Which one?
Not them. Goldie's Last Day.
You don't like PFR? You just said you like...
Fuck you! What year did this come out?
Goldie's Last Day came out in 93.
Wow. Man, I was a little boy.
That was 26 years ago.
Boy.
We have 1 foot in the grave.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
PodFR coming soon, our PFR podcast, where we talk Goldie's Last Pod. What's happening? Ah. Wow, this is hard rocking. Have you seen A Star Is Born?
No, I haven't.
That basically sounds like Bradley Cooper's band. A Star Is Born, the song that opens the movie. It kind of sounds like that. Can we hear little Goldie's Last Day real quick?
Yes. If we might have to do PodFR.
I just said that.
Did you?
You weren't listening.
I wasn't listening because I was thinking about them. PFR,
the band.
The song made me so sad.
It was about his dog dying, right?
Yeah. Goldie.
Man, this is like more elaborate than I remembered these two songs.
Goldie. It's so sad.
Wow, that's sad.
And it's the cutest little, I'm assuming it's a
golden retriever. I got this cassette in my stocking for Christmas.
Yeah.
This is, we gotta abandon ship here. Can we fast forward a little?
It's so melodramatic. But it has like this like little bouncy.
There we go. This is a jam.
All she had, not like a brother or sister, more like a mom or
wow.
A
dad. I don't remember the words. We never, this is like choice, this is legit. Barked out commands. Sit, stay, don't beg, stop licking my hands. Come now, I wish Gold could come out and play.
All right, so in conclusion, Goldie's Last Day slaps.
It's a bop.
This is straight fire.
That's a good song.
Dude.
I'm going to go listen to this.
Fucking
artists.
PFR, man. Yep. I was, man, we might have to do a pod FR.
Let's do it.
For sure.
Get him on the pod.
We're talking. Yeah, we should. Let's get these dudes on the pod.
That's a tough picture. We're looking at an image of them.
Yeah, it's like true. I always thought that this center dude looked like Matthew Perry.
Oh yeah,
and I thought this dude here on the right looked like Keanu Reeves.
That's a super group right there.
Super.
You know where PFR was from?
No.
Minneapolis, baby.
Oh wow! Everybody coming straight out of Minnie.
That's right.
We've spent way too much time on PFR.
I feel like if you're listening to this podcast, you need a little PFR time.
I think if you're listening to our podcast, you kind of understand that this is kind of PFR for the course.
Oh shit! PFR put out a record in 2012.
No way.
Called Minneapolis.
What?
Let me pick that up.
No.
Yep.
Where?
Digital download only.
Oh, bullshit. Good for them.
I'll go see them.
Okay, let's see if they are going to be playing in Minneapolis anytime soon. Magpod Nation, unite. We will all come together at the PFR concert in Minneapolis.
Oh, that would be great.
Anyway, so what were we talking about? MXPX?
Yes, Seltzer. Twitter comments.
That's
I think
right.
We're closing the question of the week book.
I think so.
Thanks for weighing in, everyone.
Yep. Okay, so I wanted to talk about, some of the things that we didn't talk about on the first episode. And Mike had said in... I think it was No New Kind of Story. He was talking about some of the other band names that they had.
Yeah.
Before
they were weird.
Magnified Plat, Shady Haze.
Yeah, that sounds like it could have been a band from the mid-90s for sure.
Shady Haze really does sound like a grunge band.
Yeah.
So one of the things that we also talked about, we erroneously on the first episode said that they
magnified
didn't
wrong
Yes.
Per Tom C.
Per Tom C, we are magnified wrong. Where we magnify all of our inaccuracies. Mm-hmm. So we talked about how they'd never released a proper album under Magnified Plaid. Oh. And while technically they've always been MXPX from their first label debut, they actually had on the jewel case.
Oh, we did. Yeah, we talked about
this. We did talk about this. The jewel case had for Pokinatcha had Magnified Plaid on the side.
Right.
And also on the actual CD, it magnified says plaid. Magnified Plaid.
Sure enough.
Under the MXPX. Yep. So just want to get that. Holy shit. I'm just looking at my.
It's pretty scratched.
Scratched as fuck.
It's like a one I bought at cheapo, probably.
Yeah, this is old school, dude. This is my.
That's old school.
That's old school. This reference is also old school.
That's how we do things here.
This is this the Danny Leary story talking about who's.
Def Leppard, baby.
It was Def Leppard, the guy who was super pumped at every song.
That's old school.
That's old school, man. That's old school.
It's going to be me when I go see Def Leppard soon.
Yeah, man. When we see MXPX next month, and we're in the audience.
Shout that out for sure.
We're going to scream out Walking By or PXPX. Oh,
my God. Mike, if you're listening,
yes,
please play Walking By one of those two nights.
It'll
only take you a minute and a half or whatever.
Yeah, seriously. Or, you know, if you played Walking By, I would probably...
I'd rip my arm off and throw it on stage. My head would explode.
I would punch whoever was closest to me.
It's probably going to be me, so thanks a lot.
That's true. I would go nuts in the pit. And just like circle pit punching people.
Yep.
Oh, man. This is not selling it to him. Why should you play? Yeah. Dude, if you play this song, I will incite violence.
Let's burn this place to the ground.
Fuck this place. Oh, you have a show here tomorrow? Okay, well, we'll burn it down tomorrow. Sorry, guys. We also didn't talk about any of the artwork for whatever reason.
Are you putting artwork in quotes? When you say that.
Dude, it's the
I'm
most...
sorry, I'm sorry. No, the John Nissen design is
it's the most
an all-timer.
It's an all-time classic.
I thought you were maybe talking about the liner notes photos, which are hilarious.
If we were to put... You know what we should do for... We might have to do this for another album or for another episode. Should we rank Mike Carrera hairstyles?
That's a great idea.
So
this one is dead last.
Yes, this is a rough look for my dude.
Weird little kind of, what do you even call those things? He's kind of got like some antenna coming out of his head that are bleached.
They're sort of like bleached, like mini...
mini tats.
Mini ponytails.
Yeah. Mini ponytails coming out of the top of his head. Not a good look.
No, yeah. I also think, so I thought Yuri it was like, man, he's like front and center. Like, is he like a big deal? Like, he's like the centerfold.
Yeah.
He's looking good. He's like these
dope little necklace.
These glasses are coming back. These are kind of like my glasses right now.
Yeah.
But I also think this is kind of funny that. When you look at, so Andy is wearing his NoFX shirt in both pictures.
Is it Mike wearing a Rancid
Mike
shirt?
Is wearing a Rancid shirt.
I remember that.
But Yuri did like an outfit change or like wet his hair down between pictures?
Dude, the stripy polo is not punk.
It's not punk.
Take that shit off.
Somebody take their shirt off, give it to Yuri. slick your hair back.
Yeah.
You know, what's going on? Who is this guy?
Yes, but I'm sorry for giving short shrift to John Nissen's dope design, because this is the coming out party. This is the debut for the Pokinatcha Punk. He's doing all kinds of iconic poses.
He's got he's shredding on a skateboard. He's jumping. He's got the running punk. This will shortly be emblazoned on my body forever.
That's right.
I'm definitely... at this point, the original, the plan is PX Head with some sort of banner that says Left Coast Punk.
That's pretty cool.
Under it.
Do you get to have Left Coast Punk if you're not from the Left Coast at all?
I'm not saying I'm Left Coast Punk.
Sure, you're just saying.
I'm repping
the
Left Coast Punk, man.
What about, like, Third Coast? You know, people call Chicago that sometimes.
That would be sort of, like, confusing, like...
That's fair.
It'd be like, you know, if you got a Def Leppard tattoo...
Which I obviously am.
And then you were like... Canada.
Yes.
Yeah. Just like, what?
Sure. I get it. Yeah, if you want to get an MXPX themed tattoo with some of these listeners that are doing that, and Andrew,
yep.
I don't think I'll be joining you.
Danny Stairs, April.
Yep.
We will be...
come and do it.
We're going to be hitting up Great Lakes Tattoo right across the street from my barbershop.
Hell yeah. Get a
shout
cut.
Shout out to Handcrafted Barbershop.
Yep.
My boy Isaac.
Big fan of the pod.
So you just can't walk in. It's appointment only.
Oh, bummer.
So it's kind of, you know, when you think barbershop, you think you can just walk in, but these dudes are busy AF.
Sure.
So one other thing before we move on to the actual.
This might be our longest episode ever.
No, I mean, we're coming up on 2 hours and we haven't started the music, so
right.
Maybe. one thing I think is weird. So Think Twice is the only song in here where they didn't bold the song title. In the lyrics, for some reason, I don't know. Think whoever is
better copy editor, bro.
Yep. Yeah. Let's go back in time, 25 years, and reprimand whoever did the copy. Mm-hmm. Do you know who Thigh Cream is?
The name is familiar.
So they're thanked in. At least the first couple records.
Maybe that's why it's familiar.
They thank Matt from Thigh Cream. So I'm pretty sure he's thanked in Teenage Politics, if I'm not mistaken.
If you try to Google Thigh Cream, I don't see any Christian punk bands. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah. So, this is the part of the podcast where... We throw out questions that we don't have answers to.
Yeah, I'm sure the hardcore PXPXers are like, oh, Jesus, they don't know Thigh Cream.
Yeah.
Saw them at a coffee house in 94.
Yeah, they opened up for, yikes. If you Google MXPX Thigh Cream... It still doesn't get any more specific. So
I think that should be our next piece of merch. Magnified Pod Thigh Cream. Just rub it on your thighs while you listen to the pod.
Yep. I would like that.
It's not lotion. It's specifically for thighs.
Dude,
only.
Don't even try and put it on your hands.
It's not going to work there.
It's for your thighs.
All right.
Hey, so one last thing before we get into the music. I just want to shout out our boy, Christoph Cole.
Mm-hmm.
He's a dude that reached out to me, but I responded to him through Facebook. And bro is from Belgium.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Right on.
And he's been listening to the pod.
Nice.
And he said he was asking us if you haven't already done this, have you considered listening to or talking about the latest Goldfinger since Mike
plays on it?
Mike was slapping that bass.
It's a good idea. We talked about the Christmas EP a little bit. We have not talked about the actual record.
It's
a good idea.
Yeah, and, you know, he's also, he's a big fan of Millen Collins, so we were chatting about that today. Cool. And they also turned me on to Old Man Markley. Have you heard of them?
I think they were like Thigh Cream spinoff.
I think so. Yeah, they were super like early Thigh Cream influence. Old Man Markley, it's a fat wreck band, and he put me onto the song called Guts and Teeth.
That's a good name, and they're a punk and bluegrass band. I like the sound of that.
Yeah. So he's like this. He's like, listen to this. This is Mike Herrera-esque. Yeah. The lyrics, not the lyrics, but the vocals. And I was like, it's like, oh, I'll check this out. So I want to shout out our dude and Old Man Markley in the song Guts and Teeth. And I was like,
listen to this.
Yeah. Take a listen real quick.
I still see my actions ripple, grinding hope stones in a sand. Losing too much kills a lion, makes mice of many men. I watched it suffer too, stuck steadfast to beliefs. And I'm apart from it.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah.
Similar vibe.
It was, it's my career adjacent.
Yeah. I'm into it.
Those first few seconds, I was like, it does sound a little Mike? Like Mike. Mike, is that you? Are you moonlighting in a ninth band?
Looking at some pictures, they got like a stand-up bass, a fiddle, like a dulcimer.
They have like 19 people in the band.
That's the best.
There's legit 9 people in this band. But bluegrass and punk, I am...
into that.
I'm into that. 2019 Andrew is into that.
He's ready for that.
I'm ready. My body is so ready.
Me too.
Cool.
Well, send us some Belgian chocolate, and we will review Goldfinger. And...
yeah, hit us up with that Belgian chocolate, bro. Just, we have no P.O. box. So, I don't know.
DM us.
Slide into our DMs with... no, I don't. I'm not asking you for free chocolate. Okay, Pokinatcha.
Yeah.
Should we?
Let's do it.
Should we dive in? We are.
It's
going...
a short album, so it shouldn't take.
Yeah, long. It's only 48 minutes, so not a big deal.
Jesus.
Sick.
So here's the deal. If you don't like this album, you're wrong. That song rules.
It song rules. The one thing I'll say about this song, we get a sense of what some Pokinatcha songs could actually sound like.
Sure.
If recorded.
Not in a garbage can.
Not in a garbage can. When you hear some of the songs live on like the at the show record, you're like, oh, these songs fucking rule.
Yeah.
And when they're not played and recorded poorly, they actually sound fucking awesome. There are some. So this in the 25th year of Pokinatcha.
That's right.
Our Lord and Savior Mike Herrera. You know, like. I think, man, what would some of these songs sound like if given a chance, you know?
Makes me a little nervous.
No,
because of Life in General 2.0.
Fair.
But this is such a different sound.
That was done for different reasons.
Sure, sure, sure.
That was was. But anyway.
Well, they did do it for 10 years and running, right?
So 10 years and running, they did. They re-recorded some. What did they do? They did.
One ad. See? I don't know. I like the garbage can.
You also didn't like. You didn't like teenage politics. No, you didn't like.
It's part of the thing for me. The context is part of the experience. It still sounds fuzzy bass. That part's good. Alright, I'm on board with this one. Yeah. That one's okay. No, see, no. I didn't want it to sound a little tinnier.
Okay.
The Bob Moon special. Take out some of the...
turn up the treble all the way.
That's right.
I don't know, but like, when Anywhere But Here starts off and it's just like you hear so much background noise.
Yeah. That's a bummer.
you can hear that amp cranked up.
Yeah.
And it's super fuzzy.
I mean, this what we said in our original Pokinatcha app was that, like, I mean, the distortion is the main takeaway from this record.
Right.
Like, it's Andy's hitting that distortion pedal hard. Mike's bass is running through something that he would never run it through again in any other record.
Exactly.
But what peeks through is like the great chorus here, and the songs transcend their context, I think. And like we said, that jazzy flourish after the chorus, the doo-doo-doo-doo, I mean, that's MXPXy. It's great.
Yeah, and Mike, out the gate, shreds on the bass.
He does.
Yuri, no. Out the gate.
Oh, gosh, Yuri.
Crushing it on the drums.
Yeah. Song is too long.
Yes. That was, I think, the takeaways that anybody could take away from our first episode is... Album's too long.
Yeah.
Songs are too long. Cut some songs.
Yes. Agreed. I still feel that way.
Yeah. I do think this song could have easily been under 3 minutes.
Yeah.
Easily.
They do a lot of these kind of like breakdowns.
They do some breakdowns. They do some fills. They do like, let's just do one last, run of the chorus
for the 15th time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Chop it up. Make it better.
Yep. They go from like having a 3.5 minute song to like, having like some minute 23, minute four.
That's where you gotta be for these kind of songs.
Right.
Keep it under two, I say.
Yep. Weak. Oh shit.
Those drums.
Oh my god.
Love those drums.
Yuri. I love that man. He's truly a legend.
He is.
There's nothing about this song that's like they are reinventing the wheel or anything.
No.
It's a hardcore punk song. It's also 3 minutes.
It's too long.
It's also way too long.
Too long.
I think the first two songs on this album are 6.5 minutes.
That's like, that should be a 30 record.
Yes. I I hate to harp on that so much, but like, like if there's going to be any critique that we have,
yeah,
it's not that like, oh, this album sounds like shit, or oh, this, I don't like a particular song. It's like, it's the construction of it. It's the bones. It's like,
right,
the songs, like, I like the songs. Yeah. I like some of the melodies.
Yeah.
They just could have been whittled down.
Yep. Yeah, I like that song. It's a good song.
Yeah, it's fun. Oh, so here's another thing. So I don't know what you did with your top three, because
stayed the same.
You're keeping it the same?
I was open to it changing, but it stayed the same.
It didn't stay. Mine changed.
Ah, fascinating.
So my original top three, Walking By, Think Twice, Ears to Hear. Yep. Your original top three?
Walking By, Wanted, PXPX.
Okay. So... Jesus, you there, bro? It's me, the girl. I'm too busy buying Cokes for my dude, Mike, but what's up?
Still my number two.
It's my number three now.
All right. I'm glad it made the cut.
So, yes, I won't say what song got bumped just yet, but in listening back to this and also listening to At The Show, those opening drums and
it's guitar, great.
It's just fucking sweet.
It's great. I
one
realized.
One for me, one for me. She's the only one. One, 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 one. She's the only one. Me.
What was that again? Was that like a demo version?
I think it was from Let It Happen.
Let It Happen. Yeah.
Yo. One more for me.
It was just too much. At least they cut some of that shit out. At least.
Yeah.
This. I mean, what I said on our last ep, I mean, on the original Pokinatcha ep, was that I think we both said this even, that like how we were approaching our top threes were not necessarily even like
the
best songs. It was like what we would want on a playlist to represent them overall or something.
Yeah.
So I think with this first record, I was going for the most iconic three.
Sure.
So this time around, I was like, you know, that approach kind of changed later, where like I didn't include a lot of the singles in my top three. But this, I mean, I just feel like this has to be, it's the most MXPX-y song on this record. I feel like it's the most, it's the song that still is a part of them in a way that a lot of these songs are not, I feel like. So
yeah,
I don't know. What were you gonna say?
Well, I think the structure of how we did the top three changed almost immediately.
Yeah.
So, you know, maybe my justification or reasons for how I did the top three, I can't think back to what mindset I was in for that necessarily, but in listening to the album again, thinking it's like the song rules. Of course I want to have it on my top three.
Yeah.
But you know, there's 21 songs to choose from.
Right.
So, it's kind of like, I was going to compare it to Let It Happen, but there aren't as many songs on here that I love as much.
Agreed.
As the level to which I love the songs on Let It Happen.
I agree with that. I mean, we are overlapping now on two of three, at least, out of 21. That's pretty good.
Yep. Wait, would you...
Walking By and Wanted, right?
Yeah. Yes, even though we haven't gotten to Walking By, that's 100% going to stay on my list.
I just assumed.
Yeah. Realize...
I gotta leave it all behind.
we mentioned Yuri?
Yep. Drums sound great.
Oh my God.
That's in my notes.
The drums on. So it Realize isn't one of my favorite songs on the record, but I can't help but just like drum along. He's a beast.
He's a little kid.
Yep.
And a beast.
He is a child.
How old are they here? 16?
They were finishing. I think they must have been 16 or 17 because
17 maybe. Yeah.
When they were recording Teenage Politics, it was
spring break.
Spring break, I think, of their senior year. Yep. So.
Yeah, maybe 17, I think.
He was a little boy, wanted to be a big boy.
That's right. And it is nuts that they were
children.
Yeah.
Minors.
Yeah.
Just tearing it up.
That's right. Yeah, it's a little sludgy for me, this one. But I do wonder. No offense to Andy, and it's probably the way the guitar sounds more than his playing, if anything. But like, when I say sludgy, which I'll say again a bunch of times in this record, I think it mostly pertains to the guitar sound. But this one feels just a little.
Yeah, it makes me wonder, because this is an Aaron Sprinkle joint. Mm-hmm. And admittedly,
he didn't know what he was doing.
He just started doing some stuff, and he's like, told the band, he's like, I'll help record, this demo, or some songs for you, but I'm just gonna give it to, Brandon.
Mm-hmm.
I think everybody was new to everything. I don't want to blame Andy too much,
right?
Because could just as easily have been
whatever
Andy was running his guitar through,
right.
Plus Aaron miking things weird, or who knows.
What if we don't have the guitar sound exactly the same on this song? Is something somebody could have said.
I think they were probably going for speed.
I think so.
Because they just didn't think twice.
Think twice.
This doesn't sound super sludgy. Now it does. This got kicked off my list.
Okay. I think that's probably the right call.
Brian, son of God! Just had to get to the We Are Brotherhood.
That's right. Bounded by the Son of God. This one has a great chorus. Everything else surrounding it, I'm kind of like, meh.
Vocals are tight.
Yeah. I think a lot of people like this one in your defense. You don't need defense, but in your rationale behind choosing it for your top three. I think a lot of people have this as a favorite. I like the chorus a lot. The rest I'm like, I don't know. Part of it too is just those the chords in a lot of those riffs feel sludgy even regardless of production.
Yeah.
Just kind of like I'm just like, I don't know. It feels very, it was 94 in the Pacific Northwest. It feels grungy,
It does. It does.
Which is fine, but it's a weird match with Think Twice. I don't know.
And also, sludgy in song talking about how we need to be nicer to each other.
Yeah.
But speaking of sludgy.
One, two, one, two.
Thank you.
I don't remember if we talked about this in
I think we did.
Mike's Delivery Corner or anything.
I think we just called it that. Yeah, this is another one where it's like kind of a bummer intro for me, and then as soon as the verse kicks in, I'm immediately super into it.
Yeah. Yes, it's. I think I also mentioned on that first episode how I wanted to learn how to play that riff because it just sounds so heavy.
It does.
But I was like, didn't have. I had like one of those tiny ass amps. Uh-huh. I was like, it didn't quite pack the punch. No, it didn't quite pack that grungy ass punch. Yeah. That sounds weird.
Get your grungy ass punch, Trader Joe's.
Trader Joe's, where we're selling magnified pod brand grungy ass punch.
Get it next to the thigh cream. Nope. The song also features a breakdown in the middle. It is too long.
Yeah.
But gosh, the verse and the chorus, I'm on board. Makes me want to start a circle pit.
It does.
In this room and flip over the
something,
table.
Something else I realized in listening to this first episode again was we really didn't start our singing until later episodes.
Yeah, we felt some freedom.
We were a lot quieter.
Yeah.
And it was like, man, we gotta start. I was like,
by the time we get to songs that we've heard multiple times, I feel like it's totally permissible to sing over them.
Exactly. The aspect. Mentioned excogitate.
Impious, another word in the song. The lyrics to the song are inscrutable, I should say. Like, I legit have no idea what's happening here.
I'm wondering if it's impious.
Impious, that makes a lot more sense. Impious, not a word. But even impious is like, that's a $15 word right there.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just throwing around excogitate and impious. I don't know. There's just a lot going on.
Yeah, there's a lot going on. And
disassociated.
These are a lot in these early MXPX albums. A lot of $15 words.
Tell you what, though, the drum fills on that chorus. Holy cow.
I'm not a big. The chorus is not my favorite. This song is not my favorite.
But that isn't your favorite?
My. I like this part of the song.
Yeah, that's cool.
And then the...
Yeah.
This is what I was looking for.
Yeah, it's fun. It's still too long. Yeah, I want more bass.
Okay.
I'm good with that.
Yeah.
More bass riffs.
I could have ended it. Minute 45.
I think so.
Ears to Hear is...
This was on your list, wasn't it?
Nope.
Never mind. A lot of people like this one, though.
My list was... Oh, wait. No, yes. I'm... Fuck. I'm...
Nope. You are dead wrong, sir.
Fuck you, John Powder. Yes, this was...
I take it that it's not on your list this time.
I'm also wrong. Right now, there's lots of stuff for me to say. And you want me to go away? You heard what you made as far as I was living in your mind. Go to hell, you feel. Guess I was really real. I didn't leave this easily. Want to leave with something you can't say. I feel so bad. I thought I know I can. I want to give you more. Don't know what I can. Have you ever... So John made a liar of me. This is on my list. This is my number two.
Okay, cool. Yeah, it's one that a lot of people like.
Yep. I can't get past the opening.
Right now that...
Yeah, it's pretty great.
It's shouty Mike.
Yeah.
It's, you know, blowing out the the speakers Mike.
Yeah.
Right now that...
It sounds so fucking good.
Yeah. I'm into it. Yeah,
I'm into it.
It's not on my list, but I do like it.
Yep. Whatever.
So two of your three are the same.
Yes, two of the three are the same.
Okay.
We now share two of three.
Got it.
Boom. I refuse to associate.
Do we need any more than that? Famously not one of Mike's favorite songs.
And I am with him. I mean, it's not awful, but the cheesiness levels are off the charts here.
It's cheese. I would rather hear Bad Hair Day over some later songs.
Sure. Yeah, it's kind of become like a classic in its own cheesy way. The harmonies later aren't doing them any favors. They don't sound great. I would also like some aspirin.
Would you like an aspirin?
I would, after hearing this song. Also, looking at those pictures, I think Mike's the one having a bad hair day. Am I right?
This is our drive time radio show.
That's right.
Tune in at 10 through 7 p.m. This is Andrew and John on your Magnified Pod Radio Network.
Power Hour. That's that song. I got nothing else to say about that here, dude.
Can't get to sleep at night. Just thinking about the day that you'll be here.
Longest song on the record.
Yep.
It is way too long. That intro is a little tough for me to hang with, but then I'm on board once the faster verse comes in.
Yeah, I think it pairs well with Bad Hair Day.
Sure.
In
the early emo section.
The cheese factor.
Yeah. It's a little bit like, I took a couple pills tonight. It's the proto version of that.
Yeah, it is, but with less steel guitar.
Yeah, sadly, that could have really improved this song, I think.
No, can you imagine steel guitar?
Aaron Sprinkle's like, I got just the thing. Run it through 10 layers of distortion.
Yeah, can we get some... get some, maybe some trumpet, get some keys on here.
Yep.
Shit.
Get that big motherfucker. Come, come.
Oh man,
this classic.
This is probably my number four.
It is still my number three.
Yep.
It is a minute and 4 seconds.
Yep.
Get in there, get out, leave the people wanting more.
And I do
love
and
it. I do.
It also, the lyrics say Pokinatcha punks.
Pokinatcha. Interesting.
Yep. There's no A.
Pokinatcha, I believe is how it's pronounced.
Oh, you're right. Pokinatcha.
Yeah, it's so weirdly, like many of the songs on this record, weirdly explicitly preachy.
Yep.
Which is not necessarily what you would associate with a chorus of Pokinatcha punks, but
yeah.
I guess God is poking at us.
I guess so. Maybe that it is.
Again, the tone.
He's meaningful to us, but not to you. He's the one true center of our lives. His light is shining through and onto you. It's your choice. He'll always be there waiting.
It's so of a piece, this whole record, of like what you've said before about, it's like, why? I am sick of trying to convince you. You're a dummy.
Yeah.
I've got it figured out. And I just, what can I even do anymore? It's
yeah.
like he's so exhausted and mad at
yeah.
everybody who doesn't think what he thinks. It's like,
yeah.
an interesting, it's not just like, God's great and look to God. It's always just like, you just don't get it.
Yeah.
It's funny.
Yeah, there's a lot of indignation.
Yes. A lot of... impiousness.
Yeah.
Impiousness.
If there's somebody who's very impious, it's Mike.
He's a little imp.
Yeah. And on to...
Moving on.
Oh, shit.
Do, 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 do. Time brings change.
And badass songs. Fucking number one.
This is your number one? What?
Yeah.
Really? Wait. I thought we already said your top three.
Wait. What is this? Time brings change. Did I? God damn it.
I'm confused.
Did I?
I thought you said.
Walking by is.
Walking by one ad and.
You're right. God damn it. I don't even. I'm so fucking confused.
What are your three?
I'm. Walking by, Ears to Hear and Want Ad.
Okay, so not Time Brings Change.
No.
I think you should bump Ears to Hear for Time Brings Change, personally. I don't, well, I'll tell you that this was a contender for me, for sure.
For some reason, I thought this was on my top three.
This time or last time?
This time. What?
I don't know what to tell you about that. It wasn't on your list either time.
I know it wasn't.
It's a great song.
Why don't I have it on my list?
Maybe it's time to call on Audible. Our sponsor is audible.com, so makes sense. Do you need to hear a little more? I vote this song. Put this one in.
Fuck it. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm changing it.
I'm into it.
I support that. Time Brings Change is replacing Ears to Hear. Fuck that song. No, not really.
No, but I agree
because,
with that.
Because, okay, my new top three is officially, I'm changed two songs from my last time.
Okay.
Walking By is still my number one, which we haven't even gotten to yet.
Nope.
Time Brings Change, one Ed.
Very solid.
Yep.
I support it. This
thank you.
The pre-chorus here feels very MXPX-y. And I love those. Not this thing, but the...
I like the sticks.
I do too.
Well, I guess not sticks, it's the hi-hat.
I dig the time changes back into the fast verses too later.
Yep.
But we are barely halfway through the album.
Yeah, it's a little rough. So this is one song we didn't get a chance to cover. Jars of Clay.
Mm-hmm. Wait a second. Oh, it's a different Jars of
whoops.
Clay.
Sorry.
Thought I was in a dorm for a second there.
Ring on my face.
It's weird that Jars of Clay started the band after the song.
Rain the days. So what you're saying is Jars of Clay picked up Pokinatcha and they're like, you guys, this great idea.
Have I got a song for you?
Have I got a contemporary Christian music career for you?
Listen to this. It's your brother. It's your Jars of...
Jars of... This is, it's your brother Clay.
Dirt. Yeah, there you go.
It's your brother Clay. Jars of Clay.
I don't even know what we're doing anymore.
But we have to. It's our other Back to the Future reference for the episode.
True. No, I believe Jars of Clay predates Pokinatcha's release.
Did you play Worlds Apart on your acoustic guitar?
We've talked about this on the pod.
Is that how you convinced Jenny to marry you?
I think you maybe even made a joke about using it for girls before too.
Did I? I'm super consistent.
No, this was not one of my jams, but I did hear it often.
Yeah. That and Love Song for a Savior.
I am the only one to blame for
just praise hands, bro.
Talented dudes. No PFR. But,
no, they're not. It's no Goldie's Last Day, no. But...
what are we doing? Let's hear this song.
We are just wasting time.
If it was Tom, you'd know, because he'd go, something inside. not one of my favorites.
No.
Not much variance there, bros.
No. No, it's fine. Cruising
high standards.
On.
Second high standard.
Second hand high.
That's what I was trying to say.
Standards.
Not one of my faves.
No, not one of my faves either. So I feel like we have like the past five or six songs this middle stretch is a little rough, but then it gets saved by walking by.
I like the next song.
Do you? You like it?
Yeah.
I don't know. It's I like that there's some yelly mics, maybe mm-hmm. some yelly Andy. I'm not sure. I'm not sure who's yelling. Maybe they say Matt sings background vocals on another song about TV.
Matt from Thigh Cream?
I'm assuming Matt from Thigh Cream.
Good old Matt.
Good old Matt. He was, maybe that's why he was screaming. Maybe the thigh cream burns. It burns on contact.
His thighs just needed cream.
Or maybe they're burning from leg day.
Yeah. I'm into it. I like the little do-do-do-do-do-do-do opening bass line.
I like that and the... I also...
Yeah.
It's really playful.
Yeah. It, I know it's also a minute and 40 seconds. Right on, guys.
This song just doesn't speak to me in the lyrical content.
Well, we talked last time about how it felt pretty dated.
Yeah.
Because there's not really songs anywhere about how TV sucks, because it's like, A, you pointed out there's a lot of great TV on at the time.
I did point that out.
And B, today it's just like, that's not really a position that many people hold.
The only thing, it's also because in the past 25 years, the scope of how, or not the scope, but like the way people consume entertainment has drastically different.
It's not like there's four channels or whatever.
No, you and it's not like you have TV, right. Network television.
There's either TV or there's not.
But yeah, but now it's like you have how many different streaming services now exist with, and it seems like more and more this new Twilight Zone on CBS All Access, whatever the fuck that is.
It's a streaming only CBS thing, which was also the only way to watch Star Trek Discovery, which I actually kind of wanted to watch, but I haven't seen any of it because it's on the stupid All Access thing.
Yeah.
And I'm going to find a way to watch Twilight Zone.
Because that looks dope as hell.
Yeah, it really does.
It's got Jordan Peele. It's got everybody we love.
Too bad TV sucks, so won't be watching it.
It won't be
streaming sucks.
Netflix sucks.
What I realized though is I think where Mike's vibe is at is the same as he would kind of use in the like throw away your cell phone stuff later. I don't think it's so much about TV sucks. I think he's saying like don't get trapped in your devices and
detachment from reality,
right? Which is fair enough.
It's a fair point, and he's just throwing the burden on the TV.
Right. Poor TV.
Poor TV. It's all right, TV. You know, speaking of Netflix and streaming services, did you watch the Black Mirror Bandersnatch?
I didn't watch that one yet. That's the new one, right? With the multiple endings and everything. No, I still haven't seen
it. It's a choose-your-own-adventure.
Yeah, I gotta watch it.
It's fucking...
It's such a long list of things.
Dude, it's a mind fuck because it's levels.
Right, I know. I gotta watch it.
It's about a kid making a video game that's a choose-your-own-adventure based on a book that's a choose-your-own-adventure where the guy goes crazy.
Right.
And he's going crazy.
Yeah.
And we're the ones choosing what he does.
Yeah. It's pretty cool.
It's layered and it's super cool and it's really fun.
Yeah. Black Mirror is the best.
Yeah. I can't wait for season 5 whenever... That is, because it's causing me ignominy. Yeah. good. I like his song.
Yeah, it's good. It's certainly been in my head a lot since we talked about Kazakh Nominee. I like it when the double time comes in for sure. I like the ending too. There's some cool stuff that happens there.
Whoa.
Yeah. Little gang vocals action.
Oh man, what song was it? Is it Jars of Clay that has that crazy snare roll at the end?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, the best. I forgot to mention that when we did that. So that redeems Jars of Clay.
Sure. Twisted Words, pretty good. Yeah.
Oh, shit. So fucking sweet.
The number one.
Number one in my heart. Number one. Oh, God. Let me just, since I've been all over the fucking place this episode, let's just reiterate.
Yeah.
Both our number ones is Walking By.
I can imagine.
Time Brings Change is my number two, and Wanad is my number three.
Okay. Walking By number one,
yep.
Wanad number two, PXPX number three.
Okay. My head has not been, it's just been all over the place.
It's the first time we've done this. It's a little confusing.
Yeah. So, like, there's three songs, and I have to, like, put them in order? Fuck.
Well, that was part of it, too, is I was putting them in order from the beginning, and you were just kind of choosing three at a time.
Yeah,
so that's true. Kind of screws it up because you're like, what goes where?
Yeah, I've been wildly inconsistent throughout the series, so who cares?
We got four more. What are we doing here, time wise? How are we doing? Are we gonna break three? I gotta know.
I don't want to tell you.
Okay, fine. Four more to go.
Because then you're just gonna want to rush through
it. That's fair. Let's take our time. No room.
Who could it be? It's bothering me. I know there's something.
Song pretty much rules.
I like this one a lot.
Yeah. So this song has grown on me. I've always sort of like tossed it in with like, you know, the end songs that I didn't really care for, like JJ's song, One Way Window, or Dead End.
Yeah.
Those are songs I don't really care for.
I'm with you.
But
I've always liked this one though. I mean, the like, who could you be? It's probably me. Yeah. I made it too long, and so it's a great intro.
Yeah. So this is nothing against the band, but
I do remember that one.
As we've been going through each song, I've been during the songs, I've been pointing out to John all the
copy errors,
copy errors in this that, like. For whatever reason, because I care for you, my friend, the A in care is capitalized.
That one's particularly egregious. I remember that one from being a kid and being like, come on, guys. I expect more from my fellow teenagers.
Yeah, right. There's
I should just go through and just mark them all with a red pen.
Mail it to Mike.
Please find the lyrics book enclosed. Yeah. With...
See me after the concert.
Yes, I am. I'm just, Mike, go write your name on the board, and we'll have the. I'll talk after class. Jay. Sound. Everybody's favorite sound. JJ, famously now, or not famously, because he was just on Mike's podcast, so that makes him famous. Oh, JJ! Oh, Jesus Christ. Let me,
just gotta hear it a third time.
Yeah, the it blew out. Don't look.
It's not too bad.
No.
I mean, it's bad.
Yeah. Think that line means?
I literally wrote it down. I think what he's saying is like,
what we're asking is, what we think the line, it's not right to sit at home. Yeah. We're the church of today, not the church of tomorrow.
I think he's just saying, don't put things off. Like, if we want to be the church, we got to do stuff now. But it's an interesting line.
Yep.
Not one of my faves. I assume it's some sort of ode to JJ Janes. It's not really about him, but maybe he really dug it. I don't know. He was their guitar tech eventually. I think just a buddy at the beginning.
Yeah, he was just a dude that kind of hung around, and then they like threw him a couple bucks to help unload stuff.
It's going to be us soon.
It's true.
Nice little jazzy flourishes at the end, though. Not there. There we go. Yeah.
Into it.
Into the line. I am myself. What is it?
I'm myself and no one else.
Yeah. Senior quote.
Deep as fuck.
Yep. One way window.
Everything in that song is fuzzy.
Yeah, not a lot of variance on that one.
No.
It's kind of a sludge fest.
It is. It seems like the song, all the instruments were played on a fuzzy, like fuzzy pedals, and then they channeled the song through a fuzzy pedal.
Yeah, the instruments were all just exhausted at this point. Just ended already.
Let me die.
But they wouldn't, because there's dead end still to come.
Ooh. They couldn't see through the one-way window.
to get to the dead end. Yuri's also exhausted at this point. Yeah.
It sounded like they pushed the drum kit down the stairs. While he was playing it, just like strapped him to the drum set and kicked him down the stairs.
If you're going to go out with a bang. A great like ending.
The one man band from Mary Poppins just like
falling down the stairs.
Just got shoved down a spiral staircase.
Yeah. Not my favorite song on the record.
And like, you know, here's the thing. I don't want to end on a negative note. Like, I feel like there's some low hanging fruit on this album to just like just kind of take shots at, but
if it were 15 songs or 16 even.
Yep.
And a lot of the songs were a little shorter.
Yeah.
It would be like no flaws.
Yeah.
Apart from, you know, the rougher early production sound.
But I think that there's my final thought on this record as we talk about it again. As some people say they love this record, it's in their top three. Then there are other people who say this is not their favorite. It's never been their favorite, never will be. I think there's a lot to love about this record. I think there's a lot to be that's left to be desired for this record as well. But I always return to the fact that they were kids in high school recording this, and that mic is an incredible songwriter.
Yeah.
And what he was able to accomplish at such a young age, what he continues to accomplish in his songwriting and he doesn't quit.
Yeah. I mean, there's a core to these songs, that you can tell there's a reason why they're still a band.
Yeah.
25 years later.
Yep.
And yeah, their songwriting skills, their playing ability and chops are on display. There's some fuzziness around that core of goodness, but you can tell that, I mean, these are talented kids. So.
You could tell from this record that they were going places and that this album at the time, it struck a chord with us and you know, I think a lot of people feel the same way about Teenage Politics that they feel about this record.
Yeah, which is crazy to me. But
yeah.
I get it, but like
I refuse to get it.
I get it in the sense that like Teenage Politics is not
it's too confusing.
It's like Pokinatcha, Schmokinatcha. No, it's not a good joke.
calling it as a joke is very generous.
Yeah, I know it's always going great when I'm greeted with silence. I don't know what I'm saying anymore. I'm just saying, yeah, sonically, probably Teenage Politics is closer to Pokinatcha than any of the other records.
Yeah.
Maybe not like song wise, but anyway.
I do think Teenage Politics sounds better than Pokinatcha.
100%, yes.
I think from life in general on, yeah. There's no looking back
right.
at that sort of sound style.
Right.
So I think we've said maybe all that needs to be said.
I think all that's left to say is Akinimai. In the immortal words of Mike Rivera.
Yes.
All right. Before we break the 3-hour mark, let's wrap this thing up.
We're not going to be able to wrap it up in under 3.
Jeez. Okay.
It deserved it.
Yeah. We gave it its proper due. We don't totally know what we're going to be talking about next time, but we might do some mic features on other songs.
Yeah, maybe. I think might that, get there that's eventually. Possible. I reached out to somebody for a potential interview, but I haven't heard Ooh. Back.
All right.
I haven't heard back from them yet, so.
Cool. Maybe it'll be somebody great. Never know with our feed.
That's true.
In the meantime, give us a follow on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. Send us some chocolate. Rate and review us. Subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Send us an email, magnifiedpod@gmail.com.
Or you can leave us a voicemail at 872-762-4763, 872-7-MAG-POD.
If you'd like to support us, head over to patreon.com/magnifiedpod. I don't know why you'd need to when you're getting 3 hours of content for free, but that's okay. There's even more stuff over
John,
there.
John, what
find.
The fuck?
Sorry. I mean, definitely go over there. You can get 6-hour episodes soon. On the next episode, we don't know exactly what'll be happening, but whatever it is, it'll be about time for a podcast at our house. It wouldn't be the same without you. So join us, won't you?